All right, guys, what's going on? We're here. We're live. Welcome to a new Poker Life podcast. Join today, guys. This is like a meeting of the worlds, my friend. It's like you probably heard this guy's voice a lot. You've probably seen his face a ton. You may or may not have seen my podcast or videos before. You may not have. But we're joined by the Twitch end boss, the man who is responsible for Twitch poker. Basically, I mean, I don't know if that's true, but I think it's true to me. So we're joined by Jason Somerville, a.k.a. Jake Carver, a.k.a. Jason Somerville. What's up, man?
What's going on, buddy? Thanks for having me. That's all very kind of you. I don't know if I would say I'm the man that started Twitch poker, but hey, it's been great to be a part of the whole thing, that's for sure. So thanks for having me, dude.
Well, yeah, I'm happy to have you on here, my friend. I think a lot of people, you know, ever since I've been doing podcasts, which, by the way, so I'll tell a quick story to you guys. When I was first going to start doing podcasts, I messaged Jason on Facebook. Because I saw he had all the videos, and I was like, hey, like, I'm thinking about doing a podcast, recording some videos. Like, what could I do? And he was nice enough. He gave me some advice. He gave me some input. I know you don't remember. You had a lot of messages and everything over the course of time.
I'm just happy I responded to you, dude. I was going to say, I hope I responded to you. So I'm glad that I did. That's awesome.
I get a ton of messages. I'm sure you get a ridiculous amount of messages on Skype, on
Facebook particularly. I'm really bad with responding on Facebook because I get so much spam on Facebook. So I'm glad that I responded to you at least. That was a better story than I was afraid it might be, that I ignored you. But no, that's great. I'm glad that was awesome, dude.
No, if you ignored me, I don't think I would have told the story. I think I would have just left the story out. I wouldn't have remembered the story. I mean, you never know. I wouldn't get upset if you didn't respond. I couldn't really get upset about it because I understand that it's a lot of messages. So.
Well, that's awesome, dude. I mean, honestly, when I met you in Cali at the American Poker Awards for the first time, I mean, I feel like there aren't too many of us that are really in this space, you know? So it was great to finally get a chance to meet you. I mean, there aren't too many people that are doing, like, creative poker content. I mean, honestly, it's like me, you, Grips, and only recently have all these other, you know, Johnny-come-latelys showed up on Twitch and these other platforms trying to catch up. But we're the ones who've been doing this for a while. We're the withered veterans of poker content creation, so. So, gotta respect each other, you know, brothers in the space here.
I completely agree. I mean, it's kind of like poker in a weird way. It's like whoever you play poker with, those are kind of like your people or your people you really can, like, they have the same passion you have. And when even this sort of thing, it's even smaller because you said there's not too many people doing things. And obviously, I think that's changing with Twitch becoming more of a, I mean, it's changing in a way, but it's changing in more of an uncreative way in that the same people are just like seeing other ideas and just copying them. They're not really maybe, you know, there's nothing unique or sort of semi-innovative about things, but they're just kind of seeing what other people are doing and they're just like, all right, I'm going to do that too. So
maybe, sure.
Maybe we'll see some new ideas, but. You know,
yeah, I mean, I agree. I agree for sure. You know, it's still great to see people embrace it, but I still think that we have the like training video mentality. It's very pervasive that people are just like they're used to making training videos, and so what do they make? They make training streams. Like, you know, they make basically like card runners videos on stream, which is not bad. It's just not like, you know, particularly creative or engaging or mainstream. You know, and you know, I think both of us have done things outside of the realm of, you know, traditional. You know, you with your embracing of PLO, which I think is awesome, and you know, as I'm sure you know, I played a lot of 5-card PLO this stream more than any other cash game over the last few months. You know, I've been loving that, so I think that's awesome. And you know, I obviously tried to do a little bit more fun when I was, you know, originally on YouTube and now here on Twitch. So yeah, man, I think for sure it's great to see people, you know, embracing Twitch and embracing, you know, even like YouTube streaming like you do. You know, it's great to see people embracing this technology. And I think it's just good to have this like diversity of content. Even like 3 years ago, what existed besides poker training sites and you know, like ESPN content? You know, there really wasn't a lot. So
no, I definitely agree. It's interesting. It's fun to talk to you about this because I kind of say some of these things on just my random stream sometimes. It's that, you know, people they're it is a training site mentality. It's like they kind of just like they're not really thinking about something new they can do on Twitch. It's just kind of like, but I gotta give a shout out. I gotta recognize obviously GPI. They've been trying to do something new with the scoop coverage this weekend. Whether or not it's been good, debatable. But they're trying something new, so I got a lot of respect for that.
What are they doing? I didn't even see.
Okay, so Alex set up they got an office in Malta. They have I think Neil Channing and they got one other guy who never heard of before. They're doing some sort of like watching the tables. Some people are playing on TeamViewer, like Liv Bory was playing yesterday on TeamViewer. You can see her cards in the tournament. They have
Oh,
some
cool.
guys in a room. They have Laura Cornelius and another guy on the couch doing commentary and guessing games and stuff like that. So yeah,
Yeah,
they're trying some new things, so.
it's funny that they're doing that and not stars. You know? Kind of interesting. Like, why is PokerStars not doing that? Why is GPI the one doing Twitch or Scoop content? That's a little strange.
No, yeah, I definitely agree. People are saying my quality is bad. I'm not sure. I'm just living the struggle life right now, guys. Let me go fix this real quick. Let me go plug something in, plug something out, try to get this working here. God.
Dude. I don't know where can I see chat on my end? Because mine is full screen just with you and me.
All right, so the chat is on
On
the
the left.
YouTube link that I sent you.
Yeah, I got you on the left over there, right? Oh,
Yeah.
I see. Nice.
What do people say? I think I would have prepared for this. I don't know. I'm dying. But my internet's the normal it always is. So I'm not sure what's happening. That's why I was trying to set it up on Twitch and on here, and it wasn't working very well. So I think, yeah, I don't know. My internet's kind of, maybe it needs some TLC or something like that. It was running a bit slow. So, oh well,
Well,
whatever.
to be fair, at least you have a beautiful background, whereas I just have my lonely fireplace behind me. Just so at least you have a nicer setup than I do.
I mean, I kind of like the background you have there with the fireplace. I think that it makes it look pretty cool.
It's very comfortable, you know, in these cold Vegas nights. You know, people don't realize how cold it gets here in the desert, so sometimes I just, you know, need some fire to keep me warm at night, you know. The life out here, it's the life, you know.
That's definitely true. I can tell you must have brought some of your chat with you onto YouTube. I can tell from some of the comments, a little bit different comments than I normally get on my YouTube podcast on my live streams here. So I gotta welcome those guys here.
That's great. Welcome, guys. Yeah, it's been a week and a day since I left Canada. My last day of streaming. 8 days of only talking to live human beings. It's very, very awkward, very strange, a little weird.
Yeah, what have you been doing since you've been back? I know you were in Sacramento with Daniel Negreanu doing some. I'm not exactly sure what you guys were doing there, but it looked like it was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was really cool actually. You know, I went with actually very low expectations because honestly, I'm a little bit pessimistic when it comes to like government regulation, things like that. But actually, it was awesome. We spent time I mean, dude, I spent one-on-one time with a state senator, probably eight assemblymen, a dozen lobbyists, the chairwoman of a tribe in California. Like, I got to talk to a variety of people about why online poker regulation makes sense. And honestly, it really comes down to education. I was at a I met a state senator who is a first-time senator, and he's like, "Oh, Jason Somerville, nice to meet you." Yeah, whatever. And then his first question to me was, "Is online poker in California legal?" He didn't even know. He's a state senator and didn't even know. And he's a poker player. It's not like some random person either. He plays poker all the time, and he didn't even know. And then his second question was, "Can I play with people from Vegas here in California, like through the regulated online poker market out offshore or out of state?" And I'm like, "No, it doesn't work like that either." And I mean, I had such a diversity of questions from all these different people that were either lobbyists or, you know, like consultants or actual legislators. You know, I got a really good grasp as to like what the politics are and why people are so excited now because it's gotten through a certain committee. And it was awesome, dude. I mean, I gotta say, like, I had very low expectations about how the trip would actually go, but it was great, man. I got to talk to, I would say, a solid 40 people who actually have some element of impact to the process. So we'll see, but I'm optimistic.
Do you felt that a lot of people there took you seriously, or do you think that some people sort of, I mean, yeah, what was your impression of how people, respected you or looked at you as a poker player?
Honestly, dude, I think that everyone treated me very respectfully. Like, I don't think there was a single person who asked like dumb questions. I mean, there were some people were like, "If we're gonna," I got a question from a journalist asking, "If we regulate poker, why shouldn't we regulate baccarat?" Like, so like I got that question a couple times, things like that. But for the most part, dude, people were asking good questions. They understood the implications of, you know, why do we have horse racing? Why do we have state online lottery sales? Why, you know? And I think a lot of times people didn't understand that online poker is still happening just on Bovada and not on a taxed fair market. And they misquoted me in the article that just came out, because they said that I lost 100,000 on Locke. But I did tell regulators and legislators that I had lost $100,000 on Ultimate Bet and a site prior to that. You know, I mean, that's that there with no recourse, no one I can call, nothing that can be done about that. And you know, I think it's important that these politicians and the people around them realize that for a variety of issues, this, you know, this is going on. You know, we had one of our sessions inside I think it was like the legislative committee room. Like, we were actually at some governmental building doing these meetings. So it felt pretty serious to me, man. I think they understand. I think they get that it's a lot of money potentially, and really, why not?
So what's your outlook on what do you think is going to happen with things? Do you think that something will come from it potentially in, I mean, I guess the outlook is many 2019 or something like that from the people I've talked to or what I've read and heard.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it sounds to me like the issue comes down to the fact that you know, this is the seventh year now that they've been trying to get this through, and in the first 6 years, it didn't even advance past the committee. This is the first year in 7 years that it's actually even made it this far, and, you know, I don't know, I don't think it's a favorite to pass this year. I don't think it's a big dog, though. I think it's probably maybe like a 2-to-1 dog to pass this year, but, you know, every single person that lives in California has an ability to impact the process. I asked every single legislator, I said, how much does online poker or chart as an issue in your office from like 1 to 10, and every single person said it's basically a zero. So it really comes down to them having to hear from the constituency saying, look, online poker is an issue that matters to me, we'll get this tax revenue, we'll protect the consumers, let's make this happen. Literally, I think it would probably only take about 1,000 phone calls or 1,000 emails to really make a difference and turn some key legislators onto the issue and maybe make this thing move along. So I think 2019 is a very good probably by then. But I'm still optimistic that it might happen this year, dude. I still think that if the right things come into play, I still think there's a chance of getting it done this year. I'm already supposed to go back in, I mean, maybe even June, but definitely July and August to continue the conversation and do some different events. And it's interesting, man. It really comes down to, like, the tribes and the racetracks and the unions, and they all want different things. And I think we can get it done, though. It's just a matter of making everybody happy.
So why did they have you and Daniel come out there? Why did you guys get chosen to do that?
Well, they, I guess PokerStars is beginning this push because there are some legislative deadlines that are happening in the next couple months. You know, I think they have to have certain things done by the beginning of August, certain things done by the middle of July. And so I think that they wanted us to go out there to kind of show just how serious PokerStars is. Obviously, Daniel is, you know, the number one poker player in the world, the most recognized poker player in the world, but he's not an American. And, you know, of the Americans, you know, I mean, Jason Mercier wanted to play Scoop, and, you know, Vanessa could have done it, but I think she couldn't have made it. So it was really down to, you know, Moneymaker or I. And honestly, dude, regulated online poker has meant a lot to me. I mean, I moved from New York to Nevada to this very freaking apartment to work with Ultimate Poker, you know, which is obviously the first regulated online poker site in America. So it means a lot to me, dude. I'm an American. I want to play fucking online poker in my fucking pajamas. That's the message that I want to get across the fucking Sacramento, dude. Come on. It's just
wait, did you word it? Did you say it like that when you said it to them? Did you say, I want a booking online? You got like a Canadian accent, kid. You picked Toronto when you were there, or what?
That's my passionate accent right there, dude. That's just the passion seeping out of my bones, dude. So, I mean, I just felt like, you know, and it makes a lot of sense. You know, I feel like people were really responsive to what we were saying. And, you know, I don't know, like, I'm still a little pessimistic that anything will actually happen this year, but every time we go, and if we meet another 40 or 50 legislators or 40 or 50 influencers every time that we go, if we did 10 trips in different regions of the state, I think we actually can make a difference, you know, eventually. It might take a lot of work, but, you know, hey, I'm optimistic.
That's what I like to hear, man. Chat said Jay Carter for president. I agree, man. You thinking about running for any sort of office yourself at any point in time here, or what?
Nah, dude, I could see myself being mayor of Las Vegas maybe one day. That's as much political as I think I could get, because that's a boss position, dude. If you're the mayor of Las Vegas or, like, even the governor of Nevada, I feel like that would be a sick position, because then you're running something, you know. Then it's just like SimCity, I'm pretty sure. Then I think I'm great at SimCity, dude, so I'm pretty sure I'm qualified.
Wait, are you really good at SimCity? I don't see you putting in a lot of SimCity hours.
Dude, I just played. I don't want to say it was too many hours, but I just played Skylines, like the new SimCity. I played like I want to say 20 hours of that while I was in Toronto. And let me tell you, my city was thriving. So hey, Las Vegas, 20 years from now, you never know.
I actually just started playing a game called Sim Tower. It's an old school game.
I love Sim Tower, dude. Another great one.
So I was like looking up other games that are similar to Sim Tower, and then I was like, wait, I might as well just play poker and work on poker if I'm gonna actually spend my time doing this. So,
dude, can I tell you what changed my life? Back years ago, I was hanging out with Lucky Chewy in London, and I had been playing a ton of StarCraft at the time, a ton. And I told Lucky Chewy this. He's like, "What are you up to?" I'm like, "I've been playing a ton of StarCraft, honestly, dude, a ton of it." And I feel a little bad about that, honestly, because I'm not working on my poker game or anything like that. And Lucky Chewy looks at me and he goes, "But are you enjoying it?" And I sat back and I was like, "Yeah, dude, I think I am." And Lucky Chewy goes, "Well, what is time for?" And I was like, "Holy shit, dude, Lucky Chewy is so right, dude. He's so right." And then he wrote a book a couple years later that had all his wisdoms in there. So yeah, dude, you know what? If you enjoy your time, then okay. That is what it is. So...
I've heard he's a very zenful person. Obviously, from that interaction, it sounds like he is rather zenful when he speaks.
He is, for sure. One of the nicest guys in poker, too, dude. Really very, like, very centered, zen, balanced. If you haven't met him before, haven't talked to him, you gotta meet him. He's, like, one of the most interesting characters in poker, I think. And one of the nicest guys, I think, I've ever met. Period.
Yeah, I look forward to meeting him out in Vegas. I mean, I look forward to meeting a lot of people in Vegas. I've never really been involved. Like, being out in LA at Poker Awards was kind of like my first time in the meeting, like, people from a lot of people from that side of the world, pretty much ever. So,
you coming out this summer?
Yeah, I'll probably be in Vegas I'm going to play all the PLO events that I'm out there for. So, I'll probably be out there, hopefully. I mean, I don't know. We'll see. Maybe next week, maybe 2 weeks from now. I'm not sure. We'll I don't plan much things, unfortunately. So,
I feel you on that one, dude. And World Series is awesome. It's my favorite time of the year, so you should definitely come on out for sure.
What's your Vegas plan this year? I know you're hosting the podcast over in Poker News again. What else do you got in store? What else you got planned?
Honestly, I'm trying to stay focused on – I mean, I'm not trying to stay super focused on playing poker because I'm not going to play every single day, but I got a bunch of different cool things happening. I'm working with a bunch – I have a couple of things that are, like, in the oven, not quite ready to share yet, but if, like, half of them happen, that would be awesome. But a lot of cool content stuff. I mean, a lot of cool broadcasting things in the works. Honestly, not a ton of poker games or anything. It's honestly a lot of like meetings and content stuff that's being worked on, and you know, basically trying to take the stream, what I was doing, to you know, the next level, hopefully here with some different cool partners and things like that. So working on that stuff. But I'm psyched to play poker, man. I haven't played live poker really since the last World Series, so I'm excited to get in there, hopefully do some work. And you know, last summer was awesome for me, my best summer to date. I mean, thanks to the Bellagio, not at the World Series, but, you know, thanks to the 100K at Bellagio. So hopefully this summer goes even half as well. That would be sweet. And we'll see. I'll play some of those PLO events too. I'm probably not going to play the 25K, but I'll play all the other ones, even though I think I'm probably a slight dog. I mean, you know, that's PLO, dude.
Why I'm playing the PLO events, because I know a lot of guys like you share that same sentiment. You're like, I mean, I play tournaments. I play No Limit. How hard can it be? You get four fucking cards. I mean,
you get four cards, dude. Come on. Dude, like, I'll have you also know, I got 18th in the $1,000 buy-in pot limit Omaha event last year at the World Series, so look out.
I think we've all know, if you run deep in a tournament, especially 18th, the top 20 position in a PLO tournament, you're practically one of the best players in the world at the game. So
I'm pretty sure that makes me the 18th best player in the world, at least at that point. Maybe I've declined to like 24th at this point, so... We'll see.
I mean, it could be someone in the chat mentions a good idea. Actually, maybe I need to do this idea too. He says, "Pro newbie, a date with Jason would be the best gift."
There you go. Wow, a gift—the gift that gives one time and disappoints, and then that's it. So there you go.
Is that true? Are you not a good date or what?
I'm not really a good dater, dude. Like, I mean, people like to go do things. I'm not really a go and do things. I'm more of like a librarian, really, you know? I mean, yeah, I'm not really a, you know, I'm more of a come back to my place, let's skip the rest of the thing kind of guy, you know? Big slut, Jason Somerville over here. That's me, dude.
Wait a sec, what's happening at your place? What, are you guys playing chess? Well, you don't know what playing chess means, but it sounds like you're playing some chess there.
Yeah, maybe a little chess, dude. Maybe a little chess, maybe a little Xbox or something. You never know, depending on how feisty I'm feeling in the night, you know?
Amen. I'm all about
that. I'll show you my fireplace. Hey, baby, want to come back and look at my fireplace? It's on the wall. That's about all I can tell you about that.
I mean, I really think that'd work. I think that would be a GTO line to use on anyone that you were trying to get back to your house and engage.
Yeah, that's how I get all the honeys, dude. You know, that's how we do. That's
right. So what's the plan for, man, my light, man, I need to study do you have a window in your room?
A window? Yeah, I have a beautiful window of Las Vegas here on my right.
Is the light coming in the room right now, or is the light blocked off?
No, I actually opened it up today for the first time ever in this room. I actually have natural lighting, a little bit of natural lighting here. I know it's burning my skin a little bit, but that's the kind of sacrifice I'm willing to make for you, my friend.
I mean, I can tell you have the white light in front of you because I see it on your face. Unless you, wait, yes. do you wear the makeup? Or are you wearing the GTO?
Nah, dude. That, as you can tell by my beautiful and golden complexion, I just show up. I turn on that light. I did turn on though, because otherwise it just gets too dark behind me. But yeah, I mean, I have a little bit of natural light too. You must have a window on your right side as well.
Yeah, I have a window right here, and it's kind of like it. My webcam is sort of like set up on automatic. It changes the white balance and the other thing automatically. So as the light like fluctuates, my camera fluctuates sometimes. Then I have a light up here too, and
right,
you know, I don't know. Someone said, "Am I playing 25K PLO?" I'm gonna play 25K PLO. Depending on how I'm excited about tournaments, I literally might be hating my life completely playing tournaments at that point in time. So, yeah. But I'm probably gonna play it. Why not? Like it's the why not? You gotta play that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I will be in there unless I have an awesome summer, but I'm definitely going to buy action in my friends that I believe in. So, like, the Max Silvers of the world and people like that, you know, who are way better than me at PLO. You know, that's the great thing about poker is that I don't actually have to battle it out in there. I can just pick my friends who don't want to put up 25K and say, all right, I'll buy 5K of you. Usually at very good prices, too, you know, because, you know, it's 25K after all. I can't really sell it too much of a markup, you know, for your action. So, yeah, I think I'll buy some action in the summer for sure in that event. Maybe from you, buddy, if you want to sell some lucky, we'll do some like Twitch, YouTube, lucky combination money. Maybe I'll buy a piece of you, dude, for sure.
Well, I have been known to have a very good podcast run for people. So you actually might get some podcast ranking yourself for coming on here. And
didn't Charter crush something after he came on?
Okay, so no, so Charter was in San Diego and I was there, so I went and met up with them, and I'm like, I know you're shy, you don't want to come on the podcast, you don't, you know, whatever, but I'm going to give you some podcast run good right now, and then I'm like, you're going to do something great, and then like 2 days later, he went deep and got first or second or third in some events, so.
Wow, nice. That's awesome. Charter is the boss. He just announced the that partnership he has with Maryland Live, right? That's pretty sweet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Charter. Yeah, I saw that, man. I'm not quite sure what it entails. I haven't chatted with him. I'll talk to him about it in Vegas to kind of see what it entails. If he's going to be like the Jean-Robert Belland of the Maryland Live Poker, like what exactly his role is, I'm curious. But
I would think he's more of like the Matt Glantz compared to Parks, because I don't know what Jean-Robert does for the Aria. I'm pretty sure Aria has Jean-Robert around because they're like, look, come play poker. Jean-Robert is here. Like, I'm pretty sure Jean-Robert is more of like the bait in the bear trap, whereas I think Charter is more of an ambassador, you know what I mean? But,
speculation is that JRB is on an upswing. So I mean, but you got to win at some point in time, in theory. I mean,
you would think so, dude. I mean, you'd think so. I mean, I like John Robert as a character and as a person. He has been alternatively nice and completely ignored my existence, depending on when I have seen him. So I don't really know. Dude, I'm always the kind of guy where if like I even barely know you, I'll like wave, say hello, you know, we'll have a stop and chat. I'm okay with the stop and chat, so that's fine. So I was walking at Aria one day, and he wears like an Aria hat, and he's walking in my general direction, and I would have been like waving, say hello. I've never seen someone do such a turn and pivot as he walked in the opposite direction once he saw me. And I was like, does he owe me money? I don't think so. Turned out he owed one of my best friends money though, which probably explained the reason. Yeah, I wouldn't have collected or like broke his legs at Aria or anything. I don't do that until like the third time I see someone, you know. So, yeah, I don't know, John Robert, who knows?
Now you seem like a pretty violent kind of guy that would capable of breaking someone's leg in any sort of given second.
Oh yeah.
So you don't follow. So you just said when you see people, because I'm sure a lot of people at Warriors Series come up to you. They're like, Jake Carver, I love your shit. You're the fucking man. I watch all your stuff. Like, fuck, man, I love you. So you at least you acknowledge people when they come up to you, when they chat with you.
Of course. Dude, I mean, I'm sure you feel the same way, you know, probably less than me because you probably actually go out more often than I do. But, like, because I spend so much time, like, working or in my own little bubble, when I actually leave that bubble, people are like, oh, you must get this all the time, but I love the show. I'm like, actually, I only hear this about 6 weeks of the year, so this is awesome. Thank you for hanging out. It always feels awesome when you actually see people, you know, like, I haven't had the honor of seeing someone actually wearing a Run It Up hoodie out in the wild yet because they only launched them in March, so we've sold almost 600 sweatshirts in the last 3 months.
Nice.
I mean, just alone.
Nice.
So I'm so excited to walk around the Rio. We're selling them at the Rio too. We have our stuff at the 3Bet booth this year, so we're launching these T-shirts at the Rio. This is starting this week. This is actually brand new too. So I'm really excited. When I go out there and I see people who are interested or watch the show and support the show, dude, it's so cool. I mean, it's such an honor. I'm sure you know, like when people. You know, either tell you the repeat jokes from the show, or they say, actually, there was a show maybe 3 weeks ago that I played a heads up tournament against some Run It Up fans, and there was a guy named Camrot who beat me in 25 out of 25 hands we played heads up, which is very hard to do. I don't know if that's ever happened to me in my life before, actually. So this Run It Up warrior Camrot crushed me. Fast forward. 4 weeks later, I'm in Sacramento, and I meet a Run It Up warrior there, and he's like, hey, Jake Carver, nice to meet you. Boy, that Camrock guy crushed you, didn't he? And he goes, that was the first show I ever watched, and I've watched every day since then. I mean, man, come on. That melted my heart right there, dude. I mean, that's a great story. You know? Come on. I love hearing that shit.
That's pretty awesome. That's for pretty sure. Awesome. Somebody in the chat said, this is about the interview quality. Listen, guys, we got a lot of new first-time viewers that come from your stuff that are going to watch my stuff now, and they, like, see this new quality, and they think I'm, like, a 5-cent PLO player who has, like, a $20 setup here. I don't know what's happening. You can watch my other videos. My setup's usually GTO. Jay Carver's got really good quality out there, obviously. He's a professional at this. He's got the Poker Stars money on his side now, so they pay him to.
That's right.
The kid's got that sponsorship money over there, so he's playing in a higher league than some of us are, so.
That's right. Dude, I got to tell you, Las Vegas internet is really good. That's got to be one of the biggest perks of Las Vegas. Is a city that was built in the last 50 years has amazing internet versus, even in New York, dude. I mean, New York, my internet sucks so badly. I could never have streamed consistently from my place in New York. And the place in Canada was even better, dude. I was getting ridiculous upload and download speeds. But, yeah, California, maybe not so great.
Frank Logan says, can we see Jay Carver's biceps, please?
Oh, yeah, dude. Ballin'.
We kind of saw them. Go back, do that one more time.
Oh, yeah, dude. Yeah, you can tell. I'm all about my guns, dude. Salty and rude boy over here. That's right. 137 pounds of iron, dude. That's right.
I wish my little brother was just here. He spent the night last night. Shout out to Tutu Andrew Cooley. He's been on a couple of podcasts. I wish I had him here right now. You guys could do a flex off. I mean, he's like skinny, but he's got muscles too. Like, I mean, there's some skinny guys that still like have muscles. They got abs. Do you got abs? I mean, the skinny guys got abs.
Dude, I don't even know. I don't have time to lift heavy things, dude. Come on. Like, maybe, you know, honestly, years ago I used to train martial arts, you know. I mean, when I was in my teens. Actually, I started karate when I was 6, and I trained till I was about 20. And I was pretty serious about it, you know, and I was probably in the best shape of my life at 19 years old. But once I found poker, dude, I just kind of, like, ballooned in weight, and it just didn't, you know, I never really got back into good shape until, you know, honestly, not even to my now really in good shape. I've just been, you know, I'm just skinnier than I have been in a long time because I've been too busy to eat, you know. So that's not the exercise regime I would promise anybody. But I ate two meals a day every day while I was streaming. Every single day while I was streaming, I ate two meals. The morning pasta, evening turkey burger, 78 days in a row. One day I reversed them, and I was all fucked up the whole day.
Are you serious? You ate that 78 fucking days in a row?
I mean, I had some, like, salads mixed in there, and, you know, I did eat other things, but those two were my primary meals every day. I don't need variety in my life, dude. I just try to make every day a little bit better than the day before it. So the meals are just the fuel to get us through the day. You know what I mean?
That's true. I mean, when I was playing, my number one and my only focus was poker. I pretty much just ate fast food and Doritos and drank Pepsi and Coke all day long. So,
nice. Sounds almost equally as nutritious.
No, yours sounds much more optimal than mine was. I'm pretty sure.
Slightly, at least, yeah.
How old are you now? Are you
28?
28. Okay, so you're
a withered veteran at this point. Yeah.
You're 1 year younger than I am. How does it feel to be younger than me right now? I would think that you're older than me for sure.
Yeah, I actually would have guessed you're younger than me too. Wow, there you go. It's funny because, you know, I remember when I got started, I obviously was like the youngest person at the poker table. I was, you know, I was always the youngest person. And now at 28, I'm obviously not really, I mean, the youngest in almost any context anymore. But you still have guys like Daniel who basically are like an adult version of us. You know, I mean, he's 41 playing Hearthstone every day. You know, and, you know, I think it's fine, dude. It's all about how you live your life. It's not about an age number, you know.
I mean, I agree. I forget that I'm that old sometimes, so I don't really, like, I don't feel necessarily like I'm 29. I'm going to be 30 next month in June. I'm going to be.
Wow.
Yeah.
How's that feeling?
It feels weird. I mean, it really does. I'm thinking about it, so let's say I was interested in potentially a girl who was maybe under the age of 21. Like, I don't even feel like I could even approach that. What would we talk about? You know, I don't think we could talk with our mouths. I think we could talk with our bot. I mean, bang, bang, whatever. But yeah, I just.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know how to really look at it, man.
It's 30. Weird. 30 is definitely feels like a big number. I mean, I'm only, you know, 20 months away or whatever myself. So, it's you know, it's interesting. I'm sure it'll be fine, you know, whatever. Also, if you look from like a poker point of view, when I started back when I was like, you know, 18 years old, all the bosses were like 20, 21, 22. Now you look at all the bosses, you look at, you know, Ben 86. I really want to go back and watch that. I showed you guys the last week. You look at Ben, you look at Jungle, you look at Sauce, all those guys are high 20s, Galfond, all those guys are 30s, you know, or high 20s. The average age of the peak players has definitely gone up over the last, you know, 5-10 years, as, you know, poker has, you know, kind of dried up a little bit. So, you know, I don't think 30 is as withered as it was, you know, 10 years ago, at least not in poker, you know.
It's kind of like those people that got really good just kind of stayed really good, and it's sort of hard to break into that space, especially now in this day and age. And I mean, I think if you have a guy who has, you know, like a Ben 86 who has, you know, 5, 6, 7 years experience, it's really hard for someone to just break in there with maybe 2 or 3 years experience. It's going to be a hard thing to do.
Yeah, for sure. I had a great experience with Ben back, I guess it was almost like 4 or 5 years ago at this point. We had a mutual friend who got hacked, and I was the computer expert of our friend group at the time. And so our friend Luke invited me over to his place. So he was staying with Ben. And after we sorted out his computer stuff, Ben was playing his own session, and he let me sweat him. And so I watched him play. I think he played about 10 or 12 tables, all 25-50. I think he was mostly playing No Limit at the time. And I got to watch him play for maybe about an hour, and it blew my mind, dude. I mean, it was one of the coolest sweat sessions I've ever had in my life, just watching him own all these different people at these. And I knew most of the people he was playing, too. And he's just like, you know, so he's so like quiet and like tranquil. He's a tranquil person, you know, or he was at least back then. Like, he was just so peacefully taking everybody's thousands of dollars at all these tables, and just like, this guy doesn't have anything. He moves all in. This guy, like, the hero calling every spot, dude. It was just like, it blew my mind. You know, we actually haven't hung out since then, but ever since that day, I have always rooted for him because he was just so nice to me, so such a sick player, and it's great to see him succeed as much as he has.
Yeah, I think you'll see that if you watch the podcast that I just had. So I did a podcast with Ben Tellerine, Ben 86, last week, guys. Very good feedback from him. A lot of people like it. But yeah, you'll see he's exactly the same way as that. Very tranquil, like very methodical when he talks. And you ask him a question, think about it for a couple seconds, and give you an answer.
For sure.
That was definitely one of my that was pretty great to talk to him. And in my chat, there's a girl that always comes, my friend Sarah DiMaggio, who I know from music festivals because we like to have fun and dance. And every podcast, she always gets picked up by a guy in the chat. Today's no exception. Audible Touchdown said, "Do you have Facebook? I'll add you. Maybe you could come by to the poker games if you want. If you like poker, you definitely like it."
Nice. Nice. Lucky day, Sarah.
Sarah gets picked up in the chat by at least one or two guys every single time. So, yeah, nice. People are still, Marcus, people are still trying to pick up Yep, that's just pretty much how it works in the chat here. So
that's probably one of my fans. You know, my team running up is all about picking up the honeys. You know, so that's probably one of my guys. I apologize for that.
Okay, it's okay, man. We forgive your guys. We forgive you. I know that you're preaching that the guys out there need to get out there and pick up the ladies. So I completely understand.
Yeah, dude. All about them big titty honeys, dude. Come on.
You know. I mean, we're kind of going through a. Actually, yeah, I agree with you. I'm out of the skinny girl honey phase. I'm into the. I guess using this word honey. This word honey's interesting to me. This is
one of my oldest friends. My parents were friends with his parents. He's obviously very New Yorker, and he calls women broads and toots and also honeys. And I couldn't quite make it to broad because that's a little too. I just can't say it with a straight face. But honeys, though, I love the big titted honeys, dude. Come on. Who doesn't love themselves a big-tittied honey? Come on. You want to know something true? The only thing, I did 500 hours of broadcasting. The only thing that PokerStars ever considered telling me not to say anymore was big-tittied honey. But even that, they didn't even get to me. It was like, I found out when it was all over that there were rumblings that they were going to ask me to stop. They thought it was a little misogynistic. And I was like, how is it misogynistic? I love the honeys. Come on.
You know. I definitely see. I definitely can understand. There might be a. Yeah, I can see how that might be a little misogynistic on, and why PokerStars might not want you to say that. So
they were great though, dude. I mean, I said a lot of crazy shit. Not like crazy shit, but I said a lot of. I said exactly what I wanted to say every single day for 78 days in a row, and never once, not one time, did they ever say, "Hey, we want you to stop saying this or start talking about this." They never asked me to pitch anything or to promote, like literally nothing besides what I was already doing. So it was great, honestly. And I'm not sure if that will stay that way, but it is for now.
Are you on? You're on Team Media with Donnie for the media team.
Yep, I'll have you know that because I bought such a big piece of them, it's actually going to be Team Run It Up this summer because I'm a whore in that regard. So,
wait,
yes.
Wait, it was Team Media, wait, how did you get Team Run It Up? Wait a second.
Well, I bought 40% of the fucking team, dude. So I said my instructions are, if we're going to buy this team, it's going to be Team Run It Up.
And wait, I love them. They're, you know, still who else has a piece?
What's that?
You know who else in this chat has a piece of that team?
You have a piece of that team?
Donnie came in the chat. Shout out to Donnie, by the way. Much love to Donnie. He said... He just let me know that you're the team. I got a piece of the team, so.
Nice. There you go. That's awesome. Welcome to Team Run It Up, my friend. I'll have to get you a T-shirt.
Nah, bro. I'm on Team Media. I don't know. You tripping right now? That team right now. You're crazy.
Sorry, I don't have any T-shirts for that. Whatever that is. I don't have any T-shirts. Sorry.
Unlucky. The last 78 days streaming. What do you know about the current tournament players, my friend? What do you still know about the scene?
The current tournament scene?
Yeah. Are you gonna pick a good team or what?
Oh, honestly, dude, I don't have anything to do with the actual team. Donnie is the brainchild.
Oh, okay. And,
so I have nothing to do with the actual selection. I am planning on streaming it tomorrow. It's going to be from the Aria, so I'm going to go over there and stream that tomorrow while Donnie and I assume Remco is going to be there as well. Those guys will make all the big decisions. So your decisions, yeah, don't got to worry about me, dude. I don't really know any of the young kids. The last young kid that I think I really heard about was about the Charter era. Anybody newer than that? Nah, I don't really know who you are. People ask me all the time, you know, this guy, you know, that guy. I go, doesn't mean they're not good. Just, you know, I'm too
weird. So some people in San Diego were asking me, they said, you had a piece of a team in the 25 Fantasy. And I was like, yeah, the Team Media. They're like, what does the Team Media know? I was like, what doesn't Team Media know? They're at the fucking media. They're at every fucking... Like, they do this every single day for the whole entire year. That's like the best team to have a piece of.
Dude, it's a huge advantage because, you know, they know who's going to be there, who's not going to be there. They've been following the results. You know, I think it's actually a pretty solid edge. You know, Donnie tried to type a lot of words to me about his strategy and who he was looking at and all these things. And I was like, dude, I don't even have to read this shit because in the last 5 years, me and Mercier basically just showed up at the draft and said, who do you want to draft? You know, that was literally our strategy. So I said, if you're doing any prep, it's got to be better than what I've been doing in the past. Although I'll tell you, me and Jason won 2 years. The first 2 years, Jason and I won doing basically no preparation. So, boom. Running it up.
Remco, shout out to Remco, by the way. Guys, please give me more money. I think I have a 2%. Please let me know if more pieces available. I'd like to buy more of a piece because now that I know we got the Run Good of Jason behind. I mean, there's like, this is such a combination of a podcast Run Good that I don't know how the team could possibly lose. I mean, Remco just like won a fucking tournament. There's no way we're like, he's going to be able to lose a 25K fantasy. So
he won a tournament? I didn't know that.
Man, you got to. Yeah, I think he went deep in a tournament on PokerStars. I believe he won it for 18K. I think he won it, but I'm pretty sure it was like 18K score. Yeah.
Wow, that's awesome. Congratulations to Remco. I'm going to see him later today. I'm going to have to find out more about that. That's awesome.
I wouldn't be surprised if he quits his fucking job and he starts grinding the World Series, gets a package, and starts charging 1.8 markup, and all of a sudden, he's looking off his markup.
Wow, that's a hefty markup right there. You know, it's funny because, you know, I've been buying a ton of action at the World Series for years now, and it's funny as I've seen the markup slowly but steadily decline over the years. I have had so many people offer me action this summer that's like the best action I've ever been offered. Now, the fields have gotten a lot tougher, but people are offering me like these ridiculous combo deals. You buy all my prelims at 1.2, I'll throw in half the main event for free. I got one of those deals this year. I booked that instantly, obviously. Like, I wasn't even going to buy action this summer, but I've already committed to about 100,000 in action just because it's so good. How do you turn it down?
Wow. Yeah, I mean, I feel like the markup is going to steadily and steadily decrease and decrease just because, as you said, a function of the game's getting tougher, and I think there's less people buying action too, and more people are aware of really bad deals because there's been, you know, Timex is always talking about these really bad offers. So I think it slowly over time it'll start to even out or something like that.
Yeah, for sure. You know, I mean, one of my best friends fired, I mean, I would guess it was at least $1 million every year for the last 6 years, and I got to help him out with that basically every single year. So working with him and kind of understanding like how, you know, what was the thought process he would use and how you would calculate, you know, how you would judge ROIs going through fields and figure this stuff out. It really helped me out a lot when I'm looking at people and evaluating action and evaluating field sizes. I feel very confident that, you know, where people need to be in order to be profitable and things like that. And I've done pretty well in piece buying over the course of my career. I mean, mostly thanks to Jeff Farah shipping the World Poker Tour event at Foxwoods back in 2011. You know, that was literally, he just was like, he was an online tournament player, and I was going to go to Foxwoods, and he was just talking online, and I was like, hey, do you want to come with me? I'll put you in the tournament as a one-time 80-20. And he's like, yeah, sure, I'll go play a one-time free roll. And he won. So I won the World Poker Tour event. I didn't even need to do it myself, dude. That's the boss way to do that shit. So I've run pretty good in my life, that's for sure.
Now, guys listening, don't be fooled. Don't go buy action now because you heard Jason had a good experience. You're going to lose a lot of times when you buy action, unfortunately. So don't be swayed by his passion towards buying action of people because it's...
That's true.
Yeah, you don't... Unfortunately, it's not always that good. Some people said something about Eat Sleep PLO t-shirt. So I only made one Eat Sleep PLO t-shirt. I'm currently wearing it. I've never made another t-shirt. Jay Carver, I feel like he's got the clothing game on lockdown here. I made like t-shirts one time, and ever since then I just kind of, I don't know, like, do you feel like they're, you know, what's the reason why you make clothes or why you have clothes? What do you think the...
Well, it's been a long process, you know. I mean, I started, you know, people, when I first started on YouTube, people were like, hey, how can we support the show? And I was like, well, if only we had merch, if only we had different ways to do it, you know. And on Twitch, donations are very common among gaming streamers, but I feel very uncomfortable taking donations as a poker player because people are donating money that is probably a higher percentage of their life roll than it is of mine, of course, you know. So I think donations are a little weird. If I'm playing for thousands of dollars, people are donating me $2 or $3 or $5. I don't know about that. But if you go to the store, get yourself a hoodie, a t-shirt, you know, and all this stuff at this point now is all very high quality. We have our stuff with 3Bet, you know, which is, in my opinion, the premier poker clothing organization on the planet. So all of our stuff is very high quality. It's going to last for a long time. And you can represent the show. And it looks pretty good, too. Like, it doesn't look terrible, you know? So, you know, I think that it's cool that people can kind of, like, you know, show that they're a member of the community, support me in the show, and, you know, I think it's awesome that people want to, you know, I mean, like I said, I think we fulfilled, I don't want to know for sure, but we fulfilled well over 1,000 orders in the last 3 months, you know, to unique people, and that's awesome, dude, like, you know, I mean, that's something that I don't take for granted. That's support right there, you know, that's passion for sure.
I definitely agree. I mean, I think I just haven't been, like, motivated. I don't know, not motivated enough. I just haven't done it. Like, I think it's a cool way because I'm the same way about donations. Everyone's like, why don't you put donations? I'm like, I feel kind of weird. Like, you know, like, I know a lot of you guys probably aren't, you know, like, you might not have the most disposable income to just donate to me. And I understand you might like the content and you might enjoy the content for an extended period of time, but I still feel weird about getting donations. But I guess, you know, merchandise is a real good way to do that, because I mean, that's a good, I just have to do it. I think that's what the thing is. People want to support you, especially if they love your stuff, if they watch you a lot, and this is a really good way to do that too.
Well, also, like, you know, how, like, you know, you and I have never really had a conversation about it, but, like, you know, trying to monetize off YouTube videos or even off Twitch is pretty difficult, you know? I mean, I spent the first 2 years on YouTube, and if I didn't have Ultimate Poker, I would have just lost money. And, in fact, I did lose money over the first 2 years I did, especially when you consider all the hours that I put into streaming or learning production that I wasn't playing poker and I wasn't working on my game or anything like that. So, you know, I definitely lost tons of money the first 2 years I did it. That being said, you know, I started out at Ultimate Poker almost 2 years ago to the day, right? I started Ultimate Poker almost exactly 2 years ago today. And my first deal from them was $2,000 a month, which is nothing in the grand scheme of things. Very small deal. But, you know, once I started doing the YouTube stuff and I had built kind of a following and we kind of showed the value of my YouTube content and things like that, my deal got exponentially bigger. And by the time it was over, it was a very big deal, you know, and then obviously the slate died a month after they gave me my sweet deal. But that's okay. And, you know, so it's you have to really think about how can you do this sustainably. You know, this obviously comes at a cost as far as time, commitment, energy. You know, you can't just – you can't really be committed to making content and not have monetization methods. So, you know, I think merchandise is just one of the ways you can do that. But, you know, well, even with all the sales we're doing, the merchandise basically only covers the guy who runs the store, the cost of the goods that we're buying in the store. You know, I mean, I'm not making a fortune over here from merchandise, but it does cover all itself, which is awesome. You know, that's definitely the goal.
Well, since I don't get to talk to any, but literally no one I get to talk about these type of things. Which is, that's a good point. So, you know, it's almost like, how do you make money off doing this? Because you put a lot of hours into it. And, you know, I think the money, do you feel like the money came from you from the sponsorships? Or if the sponsorship from PokerStars doesn't come, do you feel like you'd still be doing content even just because you're making money from poker? You know what I mean? Like, what would have been your outlook on that situation? Was it always banking on potentially getting a sponsorship?
You know, it wasn't necessarily that I was gearing towards a PokerStars sponsorship, but I was definitely gearing up for opportunity, whether it was going to be like a television opportunity or, you know, some other kind of content creation. You know, I had an opportunity to work for Riot for League of Legends. That was an opportunity that showed up at the beginning. I could have chosen them instead of staying in poker. So I could have actually switched to esports a couple years ago, but I decided not to. You know, I think you have a couple choices. You can either run ads. You can, you know, I've already been offered. Basically, it would equate to about $50,000 or $60,000 a month, if not more, if I ran ads. If I ran 3 minutes of ads every hour, it would be tons of money. I'm not sure I want to do that, though, because as a consumer, I hate watching ads. So, you know, I've always been a little hesitant to do that. But eventually, someone's going to offer me so much money that I'm not going to be able to say no. So I think running ads is one option. You know, on Twitch you have subscribers, people that pay $5 a month. You chop that up with Twitch, and you know, that's a one way to get subsidized. And then obviously you can just run Twitch ads, which have, you know, some amount of value to them. You know, you make, you know, thousands of dollars you know, a week if you have a following that's pretty decent on there. So, but honestly, if you're not gearing up to, if you're not being creative with how you're doing, you know, with either cross-selling things like sponsoring segments or figuring out ways to be like, oh, today's podcast is sponsored by Annie's, the world's number one whole wheat macaroni and cheese. You know, that's the only whole wheat macaroni and cheese for me. Like, unless you do shit like that, you're not going to make a lot of money until you get, you know, one of these kind of sponsorships that, you know, has been really rare up until, you know, recently. You know, obviously now with Jamie and me, you know, PokerStars is seeing the value. And, I mean, honestly, as they kind of well should, you know, I mean, we signed up something around 30,000 new accounts to PokerStars over those 3 months, you know, with thousands of first-time depositors. You know, that's a huge ROI for them already. You know, they've already made their money back on me probably times three already in 3 months. So, you know, I mean, I think that's how you got to think of it. You got to think of it as though they're your partner and drive value to them in whatever regard you can.
Mm-hmm. I've always been the same way about ads too. I don't like ads. I feel like whenever I listen to podcasts, I'm always like, I always fast forward through the ads at the beginning with the same podcast. Like I listen to a lot of Grantland, which is a sports one, and they have ads at the beginning now for this fucking SeatGeek site. I always fast forward every time. I hate the fucking ads. So
yeah, of course.
I mean, if I start losing at poker, I might start thinking about doing ads, but
it's tough. But, you know, could you sustainably make as much content as you make for the next 5 years without finding ways to monetize? You know, I think that's a question, you know, that the producer has to be okay with. You know, I mean, like you had asked me, would I still be doing this if I hadn't found PokerStars deal? And I think the answer would be yes. But if you had told me that I would never find a deal of that size, I could never find a sponsor that was going to pay me significant money to run the show, I don't think I would have been able to do it sustainably, because eventually I would say, fuck it, let's go back to poker, where I could, you know, arguably make more, but I could at least make probably $250,000 a year playing poker and not have to do anything, you know, as far as like work hard. I could just sit around and play online or play live, you know, a few times a month or whatever it is. So, you know, you have to be aware of the comparative options, and you know, I think that it's worked out well for me so far. And you know, I think that when you look at guys like Jamie, and as Twitch and streaming becomes more and more recognized as a valuable thing for poker sites to be involved in, it would not surprise me to see you hit some big time scores yourself not too long.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, I just like working at PLO more. I love playing PLO. I love playing poker. I love grinding hours a day. And
nice.
You know, when I start losing at poker, when I can't keep up anymore, then I gotta start thinking about some other ways to make money. But I think if you just want to make money on the internet, it's really easy to make money on the internet. It's not hard. I mean, you shouldn't be playing poker if you're trying to make money on the internet. There's so many other genres, so many other things you'd be doing.
Sure.
So.
But, you know, when you look at guys, like, there's a podcaster, Rob Cesternino, who does Survivor podcasts and other reality shows, and he's a good friend of mine, and, you know, he makes so many hours of content a week, so many, and he runs ads, he has some premium content models. I have no idea how much money he makes, but my guess is it's not a lot, but he puts in a dozen hours a day. Like, you know, like, at some point you have to kind of think about, like, you know, you have to think about where you're going to be in 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, and is all this work going to eventually pay off? And I started my journey with content creation, you know, arguably when I started my YouTube channel back like 2 years ago, and, you know, it has paid off for me now, but there was never a guarantee that it was gonna. But I mean, I basically gave up poker to do all those things. You know, if you're still trying to play poker full time, you know, it's hard to do both. You know, otherwise you don't have the time to figure out the clothing stuff. You know, dude, it took me 8 months between having my first meeting about the hoodies and them actually getting to my hands. You know, that shit was probably fucking like 20 meetings of different conversations of looking at, you know, the exact models and laying them out and figuring out clothing and sizing. And that shit is hard, dude. There are so many things that go into making a good stream, as you know, that, you know, it's really hard to do both, I think, and do them both really well.
Yeah, I think that's definitely true. That's kind of why sometimes, you know, through the past year or so, I just kind of stopped doing podcasts, but because I'm just focused on poker. And like when you're studying a lot, I mean, I studied my game a lot. I'm always working with hole manager. I'm always working with trying to get better, and that shit's like brain consuming. It's life consuming. It kind of takes over your whole entire thought process in a way. So I just kind of go through stretches where I'm just focused on that completely. I'm not really focused on
podcasting.
I'm not thinking about podcasting really. Like, it's in the back of my mind, but, and then at the same time, I get a lot of messages on Facebook and Skype and Twitter and stuff like that. So like, I'm trying to respond to all of them, but it's just, as you know, it becomes it's a lot of them. So, you know, it's fun, but at the same time, it's hard trying to balance them, especially if you're trying to still make a living playing poker.
Absolutely, dude. You know, I mean, that's one of the reasons why I love the World Series so much, because that is my 6 weeks of the year where I am going to just try to focus on poker. And that's why the Poker News Podcast works so perfectly for me, because I'm not in charge of the production. I can just show up, talk. We have still creating content. I'm still staying engaged. I'm not getting too rusty with my broadcasting, you know, and all that. And I'm still able to talk to people and do these things. So to me, the Poker News Podcast is a great way for me to stay engaged with my broadcasting while mostly focusing on poker. So I feel you for sure, dude. You know, I have one of my best friends living with me over the summer. You know, he comes out every year to hang out, so it's good to have another guy who's only focused on poker every day. That's my boy Alex Vinovsky, who makes, you know, like six caches every year, always final tables, a 10K pot limit, hold him every year. And you know, it's great to have someone like that who's always talking hands, is always thinking poker. He doesn't care about broadcasting as far as like we talk about broadcasting whatsoever. And you know, it's good to get in the gear. I'm really excited. We're like 3 days away from the first event now, so I'm psyched, dude. It's going to be a fun summer.
Starting very soon. Rich said, Rich Ryan says, Joe, you should just make pink poppy shirts. What's up, Rich? And I agree. I should make pink poppy shirts. I completely agree.
I'm going to miss Rich Ryan. Poor Rich Ryan. Real
Donnie
job.
Wait, Donnie said, does your deal bankrupt Ultimate Poker?
I'll tell you this. When I was talking to Poker Stars, I was like, hey, this was what they were giving me. And they were like, well, they're closed now. And I'm like, come on. I did not cause that. That's not my fault. But no, don't think so. But it's funny. I signed a new year-long deal with Ultimate Poker September 1st, and then they fired me in process of closing down at the end of September. I had a one-month deal where I was getting a ridiculous deal from Ultimate Poker. But, yeah, that only lasted one sweet, glorious month.
That's kind of sad. Kind of sucks when you think about it, huh?
Honestly, dude, I mean, like, you know, they had a lot of opportunities to succeed, and, you know, they made a lot of mistakes, dude. They made a lot of mistakes. You know, I mean, I think the people that were in charge were not necessarily focused on, they didn't really quite get what it took to run an online poker site. And honestly, even if they had, dude, look at how the World Series is doing here in Nevada. The World Series is tiny. It's, you know, they're getting hundreds of thousands in revenue. Ultimate Poker spent tens of millions of dollars. They never had a chance to really recover that the way they were trying to spend money. Like, they were spending money assuming they would get into California much quicker than actually was going to happen. You know, they just burned money at a ridiculous rate on things that were really unnecessary, and unfortunately, you know, they didn't survive around long enough to make it to the California stage. And even if they had, dude, I'm not sure with the perspectives they had on a lot of different things that they would have actually made it.
Yeah, I didn't follow along with them too well. I don't exactly know you know, what they were doing or what they were doing bad or how they could have done better. But I've seen how some of the American sites operate, and they operate very poorly. So, I mean, generally they're not American sites. I don't want to mention them by name because people get mad when you give these guys shout outs, these unregulated American sites. So,
yeah. Well, you know, I mean, I don't have any experience really playing on any of the American facing sites besides, Ultimate, which was the one I worked with, obviously, for a couple of years. You know, I mean, liquidity is the biggest issue here in Nevada. You know, I mean, the games just were never very big. They were never very good. They didn't really gear themselves to be a one-state company. They geared themselves to be a nationwide or a global site, you know, and they just never got into those markets. And with the amount of staff they had, dude, they were burning millions of dollars a month, and they were taking in hundreds of thousands of dollars a month at their peak. And then once they lost New Jersey, it was just unsustainable, dude. It was a house of cards, if you will, and it all fell apart pretty quickly.
Well, I'll be out there playing some. Is World Series of Poker even like a viable option to play on? Are there any games that run on there for PLO?
I haven't played on there since I became a Team Poker Stars guy, and I'm not sure if they will let me play on World Series or not. They're, you know, sometimes not so okay with that, which I understand, obviously. But they did have PLO games when I was looking last time. You know, they had some 5-10 and 2-4 PLO, but, you know, it's maybe during the World Series it'll be better. It was, you know, even Ultimate Poker had 100-200 no limit game going 2 summers ago. So during the World Series, the games can get pretty big, even online. So,
well, that could be pretty fun. Samu says, Jesus, he sounds like Walter Jr. from Breaking Bad. Kind of do.
You or me? I think it's
not me. You.
I was going to say, come on.
You do kind of sound like Walter Jr. from Breaking Bad.
If you say so, dude. I guess, you know, I have a bunch of I have a gas mask signed by Bryan Cranston and Aaron Paul right over there. I have a lot of Breaking Bad memorabilia, but nothing within arm's reach, unfortunately. But yeah, I love Breaking Bad, dude. So as a compliment, I'll take it.
I mean, that guy's pretty cool. I don't think it's an insult at all.
There you go.
I like that guy. I'm looking at my some people were more people were we have a new people. No. Oh my gosh, tilting! I'm tilting over my internet connection so bad right now. This is some of the most. I was on the road and I was tilting on my laptop because my laptop sort of broke. Now I come back home and I get these internet connection issues. I think I just have to restart my modem basically because I noticed my Wi-Fi was getting a bit out of a signal too. So I really got to GTO this setup. I gotta hire the team. I saw at the American Poker World, you have like a team of people that like I don't know if they travel with you or if they're like your workers or if they're what are those guys that travel with you?
Yeah, I got a really solid team of people that all kind of manage like different areas of things, just because, you know, like I streamed over the 78 days. I streamed for about 7 hours every day for about 78 days. So, you know, there's so many things going on between, you know, I have someone that helps me with the store. I have someone else that helps me with like the administrative section of the store. So I have basically two guys that help me with the store. I have someone else that helps me with you know, just managing like business administration, that kind of thing, with managing meetings and taking meetings for me where I can't. And I used to have someone else that, you know, my friend Graytorp, who was the first guy I partnered with, helped me with production stuff and helped me with my first overlays and things like that. He no longer is working with me. He's now doing some of his own casting and stuff because I moved, you know, away from Vegas, so he didn't want to travel, which I understand. So yeah, I've been lucky to have a team of people that have all kind of worked on this. You know, when you start, if you're by yourself, dude, it's hard. It's hard to get all these things, you know, all these bells and whistles working, and you know, it's hard to get everything in order. So having a team of people that I can rely on, and every single person on my team I can trust, you know, implicitly, and they all handle their, you know, they're all responsible for their own areas of the business. And you know, it is really Run It Up Inc. Like, it's a real business, dude. We have a real store. We have a real, you know, we have a real team, and I think we're really just getting started in earnest, really. My deal with PokerStars is between Run It Up Inc. and PokerStars, not me. So it's actually a real business, believe it or not.
So how do you see things evolving with it? What do you see that, as far as you can grow, how can you change the format in terms of, you know, what you're putting out there for people?
Yeah, you know, honestly, I think that I was really happy with my first real season on Twitch. You know, last fall when I started working with Twitch, it was just kind of like an experiment here in Nevada. We were getting like a 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. We peaked at like 5,000 concurrent viewers. Having this last season, you know, we had 78 days of shows. I think 8 times we broke 20,000 live concurrent viewers, which I was really proud of. You know, I think that we have a long way to go as far as where that stuff can just go. Like, just improving my own live stream, having a higher diversity of content, improving the production values to some degree. But you know, I also feel like the best streams on Twitch and the guys who are making millions of dollars a year are just consistently streaming every single day at a high quality. And so I feel like that was my goal for this season, and that's what I want to keep doing. You know, I'd like to figure out some other cool ways I can kind of integrate sponsors organically, because I think there's a great opportunity to talk about, you know, different brands that I'm actively involved in, and figure out ways to sell them through either an affiliate deal or something like that on the stream. And, you know, I'd love to keep expanding, Run It Up to more of a live arena. You know, we've had a lot of success. I've ran 3 live events, all in Reno, 1 in Vegas. So 1 in Vegas and 3 in Reno. And those were all awesome. You know, we did seminars, hangouts, played games. You know, it was a really cool community experience. So I'd love to do more live events. You know, a couple in Europe would be sweet. A couple more in America would be great. And I think I'd love to do some more live broadcasting. Like, you know, I think EPT does a great job. I think they do a good job of live streams. But I would love to kind of have, imagine a live stream that was designed for Twitch. Not something that was like, oh yeah, and it's also on Twitch. But something that was designed for Twitch, like an eSport, like League of Legends, that has this beautiful production quality, that has these professional commentators that are talking about the game. They have a structure that makes sense for Twitch. That's where I think that I'd like to kind of, you know, bring Run It Up in that direction. So we'll see. I have 2 great partners in PokerStars and Twitch, my $2 billion honeys, you know, and we'll see. You know, I'm looking forward to chatting with both of them this summer, and hopefully with a little bit of bling around my wrist, you know, and we'll see where it takes me, man. But I love every day, dude. I'm sure you have a similar outlook. Every day I wake up and I'm like, bring it on. I'm excited. Every night I go to sleep and I'm like, man, what a satisfying day, you know, and then I fall asleep in my usually high glory, you know. That's how I go to sleep, dude, every day.
Man, I wish every day I went to sleep and I'm like, I had a satisfying day. Most of the time I'm like, man, I could have done more today. I mean, I feel like I do a lot, but I always feel like I could be doing more. I also have high expectations, so that's probably why I sometimes feel that way, so.
Yeah, that's why that's called being driven, though, my friend. That's called being driven, though, dude. Like, the fact that you feel that way it means you have things you want to accomplish. That's a great thing. That's motivation.
For sure. I mean, yeah, that's the one thing I've always, you know, been trying to find, and is the motivation in this kind of stuff. When I play poker, my motivation was always get to the high stakes playing PLO.
Sure.
Once I achieve that, you know, then I'm like, all right, like, what's really motivating me next? And Yeah, that's something I'm always trying to find. What motivates you to keep, you know, doing this stuff? What motivates you to keep doing more, growing more, and improving at what you're doing?
Yeah, you know, I think it's going to be the same answer that you would give. I think it's just you have to follow your passion. You know, you have to follow, you know, you have to follow what drives you. And, you know, nobody ever told me that I had to go stream in Canada for 70 days in a row. I wanted to go do that. You know, it was something that I wanted to say, look, I'm going to do this. It's going to be this certain way. I want to be the one that, that kind of creates this as the baseline. And, you know, I'm motivated to do better. I think we can do a better show. I think I can do, you know, continue to do what we were doing, figure cool ways to make it, take it to the next level. And, you know, in poker, I feel like if I were to quit all the live streaming and just go back to poker, I could never accomplish what, like, Negreanu has accomplished, right? Negreanu has accomplished so much that that would be basically, I think, the high bar. I could go back into poker and aim for that, but honestly, that's already been done. I think I'm never going to out-accomplish Negreanu in poker. But to me, what I feel like, and I'm not driven by accomplishment, but I feel like what's much more interesting is to kind of continue down this broadcasting path. There's never been a poker player that also can kind of fit in this broadcasting role. You know, and you know, you look at like UFC guys, where there are plenty of guys that cross over, like Daniel Cormier, who's now a UFC light heavyweight champion, also does UFC Tonight, you know, every week. And, you know, there are a lot of successful broadcaster, you know, guys like Charles Barkley, who left the NBA, obviously not for broadcasting, but has picked up a very successful broadcasting career after that. Like, I think there hasn't really been too many poker players that can do that. And that's what excites me, thinking about what else can we pioneer in this space? What else can I do that's never been done before? And kind of say, you know, what would be cool for poker? You know, I mean, dude, I'm sure you're similar. I have consumed hundreds of hours of poker content in my life, probably thousands. I mean, honestly, it's got to be thousands of hours between Poker After Dark, World Series, Card Runners, Blue Fire Poker, Run It Once, you know, between all the different forms of poker content. So the fact is, like, I know what I enjoy watching. And so now that I'm in a position where I can actually say, okay, what can we do? What now that I have people that are like, okay, well, here are the tools to do anything you want. That is something that I find to be very empowering, and it drives me a lot, dude. Like, what can I do next? I can do basically anything I want in poker broadcasting. So, you know, I'm gonna stay focused on the World Series for now. But after World Series is up, dude, I don't know. The world is my oyster, isn't it? Both of our oyster, one big oyster for the both of us, and all the people watching as well.
Pretty much. Do you have any plans for where you want to relocate to? Are you going to stay in Vegas? Are you going to go to back to Canada? Are you going to go to Mexico? I'm probably not Mexico, but...
No, I honestly, I'm not really sure yet. You know, if New Jersey came online for PokerStars, I think that would be something that I would be willing to consider to go to New Jersey if they got in there. If they happen to need me in California to do either more, like, there's been rumors of us doing some more stuff in California, I'll probably stay in the West Coast then, which would be cool with me, honestly, having been just 3 months in Canada. I wouldn't mind staying in Vegas until, you know, August or something. But it could be Europe, dude. I could go for the UK IPTs and the EPTs in Europe. You know, honestly, there are a lot of options for me right now. I think that there are a lot of options. I'm not sure.
The chat's really funny. They're talking about, does Jason do cocaine? Is he on coke? His eyes say coke.
I've actually never done coke. Weed plenty of times, dude. Plenty of times. Dude, I name my volcanoes, okay? But yeah, no, I'm not a coke guy. If you could imagine me on coke doing an interview, it would be unintelligible gibberish, as I'm sure you could imagine.
I'm trying to imagine you doing an interview on ecstasy, because I mean, MDMA, that makes you talkative as well. So I can't even imagine you being on that.
Dude, if you're going to talk for 7 hours a day, you have to have things to say. So I never run out of things to say. I've never been bored in my life, dude. Is there something interesting going on, you know?
A standard jazz says, in these 5 minutes watching, he has said more words than I've said this year.
I saw that. Yeah. The funny thing is, off stream, I'm actually relatively quiet. You have to engage with me for me to talk. But these are my talkings for the day. So there you go.
I try sometimes to, like, keep the energy up and, like, really talk at the Jay Carver pace for, like, 3 hours. But... I'm bored. I'm just like, fuck, man. I don't know. I'm just getting. I get bored sometimes, unfortunately. So,
yeah, you gotta Yeah, I don't know, dude. It's honestly comes down to like practice, you know. I mean, I started out teaching karate to kids, and you know, we had 45-minute classes, and in that 45 minutes, I used to love teaching karate. You know, we were always inspired. We were always encouraged to, you know, disguise repetition and be creative and be clever and be energetic. And honestly, like having to do that for 3 or 4 or 5 hours a day over the course of, you know, a whole night of classes really helped me a lot, I think, for broadcasting on YouTube and on Twitch, because I'm able to kind of turn it on for a certain period of time, which could be even a long period of time, and then, you know, put my full energy in and then crash immediately afterwards, you know? So, yeah.
Are you planning to play poker after World Series of Poker? Is all your focus kind of now on other things that aren't necessarily like, I guess, do you feel like doing this stuff hinders your poker growth, your improvement, staying at a high level? Because I guess at tournaments, for cash games, it's different. Like, if you don't put the time into trying to stay at a mid-stakes or high-stakes level at PLO, you're not going to be able to do it. For I don't sure. know if it's the same at tournaments, if you need to be actively really work on your game a lot to really stay good. You know what I mean?
For sure, dude. I definitely think so. I mean, look, I think that back in like 2011, I think it's very arguable that I was a top 25 tournament player in the world. I think these days I'm probably top 250. And I feel like it's not so much that I've necessarily declined, it's that I've stagnated. And that I haven't been working on my game, I'm working on my broadcasting, working on learning production. And, you know, I've been focusing in so many other arenas that it would be incredibly, I think, both wrong and insulting to everyone that's working hard to be like, yeah, I don't have to work hard. I'm just going to show up and beat these fucking kids. Like, of course it's not going to be that way, dude. Everybody's working, like, super crazy. They're studying videos. They're playing every day. They're playing, like, you know, all these tough tournaments and whatever they're doing. Dude, I'm not fucking doing that shit. So, of course, I'm not going to be as good as I was. And I'm okay with that. Like, I knew I was passing that up by streaming all this stuff. So, you know, I think that we'll see how this World Series goes. Like, hopefully I don't get crushed at this World Series. I don't think that I will. I feel like my game is pretty sharp. I just played for 80 days in a row for the first time in fucking 3 years. So I feel like I feel pretty good about my game these days. And, you know, I think the World Series is a good chance for me to get out there and prove I can still hang with those young lions, even as a withered veteran as I am.
What is it, withered? I've never used the word withered in my life. You used it like 10 times. I gotta start thinking about this word.
Yeah, I love fucking withered, dude. It's a great, think about what it makes you imagine, dude. You think of like a withered, like, you know, like orange, dude. Like, it's a great word to describe veteran status. So yeah, that's a run it up word right there. Just like your poppy and like, dude, it's a run it up word. I love the withered, dude.
What was the word you just said? What did you just say?
The poppy, dude.
Oh, poppy! I know poppy. That's one of my words. GTO has been one of my new words too.
Yeah, GTO. Yeah. For
I've
sure.
been using GTO lately, man. There's some people on they're not very happy about me using GTO so much. They're sending me, I'm getting some backlash. Like, dude, maybe you need to get a new word. I'm like, fuck you, man. I'm gonna keep using GTO as much as I want to keep using it. So
it's a great word, dude. It's a great word for sure.
Really is a powerful word. See, the thing that you said about, you know, that if you spend time doing what you're doing now, streaming, that you understand that you're going to be, and that it's going to drop. That's something I can't do. I just can't like make that sacrifice. It's so hard. I just can't, I don't know, man. I can't do it. I can't
sure.
do it. That's yeah. one thing I struggle with for sure.
We only have so many time units, right, in every day. So you have to assign those to, you know, relaxation time, social time, girlfriend time, poker time, broadcasting time. You have to assign those in every week to whatever you want to focus on. And, you know, for me, I realized that if I was going to try to stream as much as I was gonna, you know, I went down to Ultimate Poker for marketing meetings fucking 3 times a week or 2 times a week, you know. I mean, I passed up playing poker and trying to train my hardest at poker to learn all those things, and I'm not regretful of that. But I am gonna have to acknowledge that I'm not at my fucking peak. Like I can't probably beat the 25-50 game at Bellagio tonight. Like I probably couldn't beat that game. I mean, maybe I could, but you know, I certainly could have beat it 2 years ago. You know, I'm not sure if I could beat it today though. It's okay. You know, you pass up one thing to get another. That's how it goes.
Do you have anything worked out with Poker Central, the new 24/7 poker network? Have you talked to them at all about doing any work with them?
Yeah, I had a chat with them. For the first time last week. It seems interesting. No, we didn't really get to any of the nitty gritty, but you know, obviously they're looking for poker content, and you know, I have a pretty big library of poker content myself, and we're happy to be make new stuff with them. So, you know, I'm not sure how that will go, but I'm optimistic. You know, it's cool that they're doing that shit. You know, good for both of us. I think that they're doing that shit. You know, having anybody get involved in the poker broadcasting arena is only good for poker broadcasters. So, hopefully it works out. I'm not so confident that they're. You know, I'm not so sure. You know, they have a tough road ahead, dude. I mean, like, if I told you, hey, man, I want you to go start a poker TV channel, that's fucking hard. You know, to be a profitable poker channel, that's going to be a difficult undertaking. So we'll see. We'll see how it goes.
Yeah, to be profitable, that's the question. You know, how are you going to make money? If you want to get new content, you got to pay people to create the content. So it's kind of like, yeah, it's going to be challenging for sure.
It's tough, especially if their model is only basically an ad-based, you know, model. How do they run that off of, you know, 18 minutes of ads an hour? What kind of viewership are they going to get? Like, I don't think they're going to get more viewers than on average per hour or per day even than I was getting. And I have a decent understanding of what my advertising space sells for, and I'm not trying to pay a big production team or anything else, you know. So I'm not so sure, but, you know, hopefully they'll figure it out, and I'd love to be a part of the team if they want me.
Do you think that PokerStars, I guess PokerStars wouldn't care. They would like it if you worked with...
Well, they've already agreed for Daniel to do it, so I assume that wouldn't be an obstacle. If they're going to let Daniel do it, I'm pretty sure they'll let me do it too. Their perspective is, you know, basically, you know, live and let live in these regards, unless there's something that's like a conflict. Or, like, I think if I had told them I was going to go to Reno for an event instead of playing Scoop, they would have been pissed, you know, something like that. But they've been great, dude. They've been very hands-off, which is how I like it. They let me be basically completely independent, which is how I like it. And, you know, we're a quarter of my way through my deal with them, and I think it's been good for all parties. You know, I think they're happy. I'm sure they're happy because I've driven them thousands of, you know, first-time depositors and things like this. So I'm sure they're happy. I'm happy. I feel like we've had a good first 3 months together, and we'll see what the rest of the year brings.
It'll be interesting to follow. It'll be interesting to see. I mean, I'm sure you're only going to keep getting... you know, more popular on Twitch. How much do you think you can actually grow on Twitch? How many more people do you think you can get coming to your streams? Do you even want, I mean, I kind of hate it when so many people are in the streams where the chat's like terrible. Like, I like chatting. I like communicating with all the regular people that come.
Sure.
Like, how much bigger do you think you can get? Do you want to get bigger? Do you wish it was smaller kind of, so you could have that more like sort of communicative?
You know, I think it's kind of cool that, you know, you can have different shows, different feelings of different shows based on the day of the week. Like, Friday and Saturday are always the smallest days. Like, they're just always the smallest days of the week. So, you know, on Saturday, I don't think we ever broke 7,000 concurrents on Saturdays. You know, meanwhile, on Sundays, Mondays, Tuesdays, I think Thursday was actually my best day because I cashed that tournament twice, made some deep runs in that 1K a couple times. You know, we had, you know, 20, 25,000 concurrent people, and that's just a different feel of a show. Like, it almost feels like, I think it's okay. You have, sometimes we had like micro stakes Monday, sometimes we played home games, sometimes we did all these things. Like, I think it's awesome to see that. And would I like it to grow? Yeah, I definitely would like it to grow a little bit more. You know, I mean, I think you look at like the biggest and most vibrant Twitch communities, like, my Twitch idol is a guy named I'm a Cutie Pie who streams League of Legends, and he averages 25,000 concurrents. Averages 20 or 25,000 concurrents. So, you know, I think that he manages his community very well. He has some different things that he does to keep his community engaged and involved, and I think we could grow that big. I think people want to watch poker content. It's pretty obvious they do. You know, people want to consume this stuff. So I think as I continue to improve the quality of it, continue to, you know, just generally improve the show, I think we can get those numbers up. Like, I think that if I had one, let's say I had one or final table to Scoop event in that week I played Scoop, I think we would have probably been a favorite to break 30 or 40,000 concurrents, which, you know, it would have been insane. So, you know, I those things don't, like, really matter to me, but I'd like to do them. You know, someone's going to do them, might as well be me. So I'd like to get there and make that happen, but, you know, we'll see, dude. I think it's awesome. Poker has done so well on Twitch, and poker was against the fucking terms of service fucking a year ago on Twitch. And it's only been okay to stream poker as of October, so long way still to go.
Do you think any up and comers are coming on there? I know we got Elky, so sick, so I can't do French. So sick.
No, I can't do it. So sick. He does a great job, dude.
Fucking Elky, dude. God, I love Elky. Yeah.
Elky's great, dude. One of the original bosses for sure.
So who else is that? I know are there any up and coming streamers on Twitch that are gonna be streaming after the scoop's over?
Well, you got Dan O'Brien, who's here in Nevada. He'll be keeping streaming through the World Series. One of my best friends, you know, he'll be streaming a bunch. So Dan's still going to be
around. Shout out to Dan O'Brien, by the way. I liked it. He did a series. I remember he did something on Ultimate Poker, like a little one-on-one sort of thing with
With Demon Girl.
Yeah, that thing was. Those things were funny. I like those things.
Yeah, those were great, right? So Dan's still around. I think Jamie's going to still keep sticking around streaming. I asked him if he was going to come play the World Series, and he said he wasn't planning on playing very much because of bankroll considerations. You know, he only turned pro, I think, like last year or something, so he's still pretty new to the poker game generally. And, you know, Dutch streams a bunch here from Nevada. So, you know, I honestly don't spend a ton of time watching poker streams because when you spend every day streaming poker, when my stream is over, I don't really want to watch more poker content, you know.
Yeah.
But you know, people have done a great job. I have caught, you know, decent numbers of content, things like that. So I think poker on Twitch is going to do really well this year, man, for sure.
I have to correct your statement. I'd actually like to watch more poker content, provided it was different or unique or something that I enjoy personally. But I guess if it was high stakes PLO, I'd watch it. But maybe that's a function of just me, my taste and what I enjoy watching is slightly different now than what it was. Because when I was younger, I liked listening to all the podcasts. You know, I love Bart Hansen's podcast. I love the 2+2 Poker podcast. I love all the TV shows. I loved all that stuff. And kind of as I've, you know, now these days, it feels like most of that content's not really directed towards me. It's directed towards more the recreational players or the beginner players. And towards someone like myself, none of the content's really directed at me. And that's what I wish there was more of.
That sounds like opportunity to me, my friend. That sounds like you should get on Twitch and start streaming some high stakes PLO.
I will never stream myself playing anything above. I will never stream myself playing mid stakes to high stakes PLO in my entire life. I think that's one of the most dumbest things you could possibly do is give away. If you're playing in a game, especially like PLO, where it's very hard to make a living at 2-4+, it's dumb to give away this free information to people. Like I understand why people do it at No Limit, but at PLO, that's why no one at PLO is doing it either. I mean, if you kind of look in there, no one's really doing it.
Sure, you know, I know Roy has been streaming a little bit. I don't know if you know Godlike Roy, but he's been streaming a little bit. Mm-hmm. I think that you have to be okay with the fact that you're giving up value. Like, I don't disagree with you. You, of course, are giving up value by giving away information. But, the PLO content out there is not great, obviously, on Twitch. It's not. Most of it is hold'em. Most of it is multiple tables, which is, you know, very uninteresting, you know, for someone like me. But I think content will get better on there. We've already seen, like I said, GPI trying different things and mm-hmm. PokerStars trying different things. And I think as time goes on, we'll see a more of a diversity continue to expand there on Twitch, you know.
Yeah, well, up-and-comer Adrian Phoenix. Have you ever watched Adrian stream on Twitch? He gets like 300 or 400, 500 viewers per stream now, but he's an up-and-comer. He's in the streets. He's in the streets from Montreal. He's going to be on a podcast. He's going to be on a podcast Wednesday, guys. He's been one of my friends for a long time. So.
Cool. That's awesome.
Yeah, we're going to have him on there. So we'll take some questions from the chat, and we'll see if anybody out there has any interesting questions that don't involve So Sick or Mouse 5 or Mouse or whatever. I love the mouse. I love using the Elky smiley faces. They're on Twitch. They're so good.
His are pretty good for sure.
Are you following the Scoop main event at all on PokerStars?
No, I'm not. I probably should be, but no, I'm not. I don't have any pieces of anybody, so I don't really care that much. You know,
I'm interested from a railing perspective. Isildur's deep in the main event, the high main event for 1.3 million for first place. So if he wins that, then he might play some more high stakes PLO, and then I could. Yeah.
That would be nice.
Yeah, there's 19 people left in that. If you're watching this back like 6 months later, guys, this is the Scoop main event. You know, hey, it's 1.3 million for first place. So
that's right.
So yeah, Isildur is still in that, and Sean Deep. I guess he's the only other name in there, really. Yeah, no one else of note that I've ever heard of before is still alive in this. So
cool.
So yeah, what do you got planned here until the World Series? You just gonna take it easy?
Oh man, I got so many meetings and things today because, you know, I wasn't in Vegas until Friday from Sacramento, and I was only in town for like 24 hours before I left to go to Cali. So I have a whole bunch of things. I'm going to supposedly meet with Donnie and Remco today, and I got to sort out so many different things in the next 2 days because the World Series starts Wednesday. So today's a holiday, obviously, so nothing's even open today. So tomorrow I got to take care of a lot of shit. But it's all good, dude, you know. It's another day in the life.
You're going to be streaming tomorrow on your Twitch channel for the Fantasy Draft?
Yep, I'm going to stream, unless something strange happens with internet or something. I'm going to plan on streaming tomorrow the 25K. I think it starts at 7 p.m. my time, I think. So that's almost like 29 hours from now if you're watching. So, yeah, that'll be tomorrow. RunItUp.tv on my channel. I'll be streaming the 25K.
That'll be awesome. I'm excited to see that. I'm excited to see who I get. Hopefully I get like some people I like on the team that I have a piece of.
Yeah, I got to get myself set up for that, actually. That's something else I got to do tomorrow. So this is my new laptop, so I haven't actually streamed off it before. This is my first ever stream thing, actually, off this, so I got to get ready for that tomorrow, too.
Brandon, it says, what's the best way to follow World Series of Poker action? PokerNews.com, baby, right? Isn't what's the best way to follow the WSOP updates?
Well, I don't know anymore because Poker News isn't running the coverage this year, so now it might be WSOP.com. I'm not actually sure anymore. Maybe Poker News still is the best way. I'm not sure. We'll find out. This will be weird. This will be a unique year. First time no Poker News as the main coverage.
I don't like it. I don't like it at all.
We'll see. The funny thing is, according to the World Series people, they basically have half the Poker News team anyway, working for poker for World Series directly. So we'll see.
We'll see how that goes. Do you have any other streams planned outside of podcasting? You're going to be podcasting almost every day for Poker News, right? So people can listen to you on there too.
Yeah, three days a week. We'll be actually streaming those also on my Twitch channel, or at least so is the plan for now. So so yeah, I'll be on the Poker News podcast 3 times a week this summer. I'm planning on trying to stream some other games while I'm in Vegas, but I'm not really sure about that. I'm also going to do things like hand history reviews, stuff like that, but you know, honestly, I am planning on this being the low, slow season, and then once this World Series is over, then I'll be back at it. I'm also potentially going to be doing some World Series streams, you know, for them, the World Series commentary stuff over the summer, so I'll be around. It'll just won't be like it was where I was in one place, one channel, same time every day.
Do you do like a mailing list or something like that, or is the best place people will find the updates are on Twitter?
Yeah, at Jason Somerville on Twitter is the best place to find updates. Like, I've retweeted this. You know, I'm going to tweet about everything that I'm doing that's even remotely interesting. So that's the best place to keep in touch with me.
Cool. Do you have any who's your favorite poker player? Is it someone you follow really well? Or someone that you have a favorite guy that you root for or you rail or you cheer for or something like that?
I love Phil Grusome, man. Phil Grusome is just he's like the perfect poker player. He is classy, hilarious, a sicko. There was a hand I played against him in the 25K high roller in Monte Carlo where he raised the button. I called with 10-9 in the big blind. It came like queen 9-3. I checked. He bet. I called. Turn was like a 7. I checked. He bet. I called. River was like a 4. I checked. He bet again. And as I'm tanking, he winks at me. He winks at me. The perfect European wink. And I was like, what does that mean? What does a wink mean? I have no idea. So I was going to call anyway. So I decided to call. And he had Jack 9. He had me 1 pipped. And with the wink in there, I was like, that's it. You're my favorite poker player of all time. 3 streets of value. And you winked at me on the river. All right. You got it, dude. So he is so funny, man. He is a hilarious guy. So I really like Phil Grusome a lot. But there are so many good guys in poker. You know, there are so many good people in poker that, you know, it's easy to root for people, I think.
Is there anybody that's helped you the most over time, any poker player at all?
Yeah. You know, I mean, an easy one to point out to you is Daniel, because the advice that Daniel has given me has been absolutely tremendously valuable. You know, I mean, he's, you know, the number one poker ambassador of all time. No exclusions there. So the fact that I've been able to spend, you know, even 100 hours in my life talking to him is unreal, unreal valuable. There's no price you could put on that. You know, so Negreanu is an easy one, but, you know, so many of my friends, you know, I started out back 10 years ago on the Something Awful forums with Leo Walpert, Vivek, Alex Vanovsky, Steve O'Dwyer, Max Silver. You know, those were my core guys that I basically have been friends with now for a dozen years. So, you know, without all those guys talking poker with me and just being, you know, good friends to me over the years, there's no chance I would be here today. So I owe a lot of gratitude to all those guys for sure as well.
So it's kind of like a combination of people that you've had with you over the years.
It takes a village to raise the poker player, I think is the phrase. So, yeah.
I'd personally disagree with that, but I mean, I think you can do it by yourself in theory, but yeah.
Yeah, you definitely can. Look at like Sauce, right? Or Jungle Man, I guess. One of those two. Or are they like self-trained? Isildur, maybe? I don't know. But you definitely don't have to do it that way for sure.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Jungle, I don't even know who Jungle's like his like group of people he like chats poker with now are.
Yeah, I don't know.
His girlfriend. He's always with his girlfriend. They're always traveling, posting pictures on Facebook. They're all lovey-dovey. They're doing this, they're doing that. He's filming something now, so.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't really follow his life that closely, but he's also a cool guy.
I've had him on the podcast a couple times, so I chat with him. I like him a lot. I'm excited to see him in Vegas. I feel like he actually parties more than you'd suspect the Jungle Man would party, so I'm excited to see him out there.
Nice. Who would have thought?
Believe some of the things he said, I would never have thought these things too. Like he said some things, and I was very surprised that the Jungle Man was telling me these things. So
yeah, you think he'll open up to you, huh? People just open their hearts up to you here on the podcast.
That's what they say. I mean, they say about the podcast, some people just
free flow of love.
I don't know. I don't know how it happens, my friend. I don't know. Maybe sometimes if my quality's better. They just open up to me because they get to see me in HD in the face. They get to see. Normally my hair is long. It's flowing. Yeah,
just think about it. With HD. Oh my God, dude! I'd be telling you all my secrets. You know?
Right. Like a big what is it? Big breasted honey? What is it called?
Big tittied honey. Excuse me, please. Big tittied honey. Yes.
Okay, a big tittied honey. Okay, big.
That's right, dude. That's how we like. One for the left, one for the right. That's how we do.
We need to want a big titty left, a big titted honey on our left and on our right.
That's right, dude. That's right.
GTO? Okay, GTO. Some impressions people want to hear. Do you have a Hollywood Haxton, Hollywood Ike Haxton impression?
I don't really do impressions of people very well. You know, like Daniels does an amazing job. My best impression these days is of Negreanu. Here it is. Ready? Heh! That's it. It's just an obnoxious laugh. That's it. I really can't do impressions of people, dude. I just do impressions of, like, you know, like Twitch chat, you know, very nerdy Twitch chat, crying, complaining. You know, why do you do this, Jay Carver? Jay Carver, you're the worst. I don't understand. Like, you know, things like that, dude. Like, that's basically all we get to around here. I get that one a lot, you know, Twitch chat.
What's the thing you get from the Twitch chat? What do they say to you?
They're just very salty. Jay Carver, I don't understand. How can you be so bad and play poker like this all the time? It's like basically, it's a little bit of my mom actually in there as well. You know, my mom is in there too. So yeah.
Wait, how many women watch your stream? Why are some women commenting on your things?
Say that again. Sorry, you cut out a little bit.
It sounds like you get a lot of women with that impression.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know the numbers on Twitch because it doesn't tell you, but on YouTube we had about 9% women.
You have 9% women? No way.
On YouTube, back in the day. I don't know what we are on Twitch. I would guess it's probably under that. I mean, almost for sure. But you'd be surprised, dude. We got a bunch of women on the stream. People tweet at me all the time, and they're like, you know, hey, I'm a 67-year-old woman from Scotland that I watch every day. I was like, wow, who would have thought? You know, we get a lot of people, dude.
Shit, man, how do you get? I got 3% women. How do you get 9% women?
I mean, I would guess my numbers on Twitch are probably around that. You know, we had 3 million unique people come through the show in the last 3 months. So I would be shocked if we had 150,000 women. You know what I mean? That's 5%. I would be shocked if that's true, honestly. But maybe like 2%. That would make more sense.
What women? What do they call it? You look like a Canadian accent in there or something.
Dude, I don't know. I just am a man of the world now. I have little pieces of accents from everywhere. My Long Island accent's gone. You know, I used to be the town of water and coffee. Nah, no more. Now I'm coffee and water. Hmm. You know, yeah. Time has softened my accents.
Do you ever get any groupies that are propositioning themselves to you? Maybe they want to engage in some sort of intimate, loving
no
with you or something like that.
No, you would think that after all my honey related comments that they would just be flocking to me, and sometimes they do, but you know, no, I actually have never hooked up with someone from the poker world. That's true. I've only hooked up with civilians, never poker players. That's true.
I mean, it's probably a smart idea not to get involved with people from poker world, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I mean, I've never even had, I've had some opportunities, but I've never really been interested.
Aren't you dating somebody right now?
It's complicated. You know, it's one of those situations where, I don't like to talk about it very much on the podcast, like things about like my personal life or like my actual parents. Like, you know, I feel like I talk about so much that I try to keep like some of it kind of guarded, because otherwise, like, I don't want it to be my journal. Like, it's not my fucking Tumblr. You know what I mean? So I try to stay focused on the stuff that most people want to talk about. So I don't want to talk about like my personal life or things like that. But it's all good.
You keep some of that close to you, huh?
Yeah, you know, I mean, you got to. Otherwise, what am I talking about? Every single thing that I'm doing in my life, you know, I don't know. Otherwise, you know, I got to keep something's mystery. You know what I mean,
it's a good way to do it. I feel like I talk about a lot. I talk about, you know, some chess matches with some women. I mean, when I had a girlfriend for a while, I guess I didn't talk about it that much. Yeah, I don't think I've talked about that much, but yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, it's probably more GTO. I certainly don't talk about women from poker I've hooked up with in the past, because what good is that going to come from that, man? You know what?
That's going to cause a mess. You know, I mean, I'm focused on streaming, you know, I'm focused on work and business, and honestly, I spend every hour of every day basically working, you know, so, you know, I'm not in any kind of like closed, exclusive kind of relationship, you know, and I haven't really been for years because I don't have the time, you know. I mean, if you're really passionate and committed to something, you only have so much bandwidth, and so, you know, I'm open to experiences as they come through, but honestly, I'm focused on work. I'm focused on trying to get things done, and, you know, I'm not out partying or clubbing or anything like that. You know, I'm focused on my goals, and, you know, it is what it is.
No, I think I've been that way. I mean, I pretty much was that way for 4 or 5 years when I first started playing poker. Like, my only focus was getting better at poker. My focus wasn't, sure. You know, I wasn't putting any energy into relationships because I didn't think that I could have the most success I could have doing what I was doing if I was having these relationships. And that's kind of the mode I've gone back to for the most part, was that I kind of would rather, in a way, it's like you're sacrificing a relationship or you're sacrificing that type of thing. But I'm kind of the same way you are. I'd rather focus on the things I'm doing, what I'm working at, what I'm trying to get better at. And then in time, I feel like that will happen too. But do you ever feel like at some point in time, you know, do you ever worry that you get too old or something like that happens? Are you not worried about it at all? You know that at some point in time, something will come from it and then you'll be in a good spot?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I mean, obviously I'm 28 now and having kids means a lot to me. You know, I mean, I always enjoyed working with kids, and I like to have kids sooner rather than later because, you know, my dad was such a big influence on my life. I like my kids to have as much exposure to my dad as possible. So, you know, I think by the time I'm like in my mid-30s, I like to start having kids, but that still could be up to 7 years away. You know what I mean? So I think, you know, I want to work really hard for the next 3 or 4 years, you know, really focus 95% of my days on the stream, on all the run it up opportunities that I have related to that. And then when I get to my lower 30s, then start kind of planning out, you know, where am I going to live for the rest of my life, and then settling down and then going from there. I think it'll be okay when that time comes. You know, there are plenty of people that I'm close to in my life. So I think I'll be okay when the time comes for that. But, you know, I'm not really worried about it. My life has always been like that, dude. Shit just eventually comes my way. You know, I've never stressed out about money or, you know, relationships or things like that. You know, it is what it is. I'm an open universe kind of guy. People collide, they depart. You don't see people for 2 years, you see them again, and then it's like no time has passed at all. Mm-hmm. You know, to me, I don't really try to hold grudges. I don't. You know, I just, you know, we have nice positive interactions, and then life continues. You know, I'm not a possessive person. I used to be a lot more spiteful and angry when I was like in my low teens or my teens and my low 20s. But at this point, dude, you know, live and let live. Everybody just peace and harmony. And come on, can't we just all get along? Is that so wrong?
I think I tend to generally be very, very similar to you on that outlook and that mindset about things. And especially the whole seeing people for not a long time and you see them again, especially with traveling so much, living in different places. you know, being in the poker world where you're going, you don't see people, they move and stuff like that. So, yeah, I think that's something you kind of have to be, you kind of have to be good at, is sort of like being able to lose people from your life and sort of have them long distances. And then sure. when you connect with them, you can catch up with them and, you know, you can potentially build something with them, either a friendship or whatever. It, you know, sometimes it happens, sometimes it won't happen. It's just, it won't be able to happen.
For sure. You know, I mean, we have all these great tools to stay in touch anyway, if you really want to, on Twitter and Facebook. But, you know, I don't even really have the time to stay in touch with too many people. So, you know, I'm sure there are people who think I hate them because they called me, left me a voicemail, and I never even noticed, and I never called them back. Like, I'm sure there are plenty of people that feel that way about me. But, you know, I don't mean anything bad by it. I just have a lot of things going on. And, you know, I just try to enjoy every day, and I work really hard, you know, every day, and, you know, let everything else kind of figure itself out, you know.
Are you going to do the Joe Rogan podcast this summer? Someone asked. Rostic 42.
I heard that Joe was just talking about Twitch the other day, and they were talking about Twitch poker and me even. So, I mean, I'm a huge Joe Rogan fan, so it seems like the doors are finally opening up.
Damn, man. That'll be awesome if you can get on there. You're like, Hollywood Hexton was on there too.
Dude, I would love that. Are you crazy? I would love that. I promise you this too. If I get an opportunity where Joe Rogan offers me any sort of like fucking blunt or anything like that, I promise you I'm going to say yes. I'm not going to turn it down. I had an opportunity to smoke up with Phil Locke when I was 18 years old at Australia, my first 10K ever, and I turned it down. It was my first 10K ever, and I had never smoked before in my life. But if Joe Rogan offers me on the podcast, I'm doing it, dude. I'm doing it. I'm not gonna say no. Poker Stars patch on me or not. Doesn't matter, dude. Fucking fire it up.
That's what I like to hear, man. People in the chat said you'd be a good wingman, but then someone speculated you might steal all the big what are the big titty honeys?
Yeah, the big titty honeys, dude. They just flock to me, you know, I can't keep them away. I'm just like, come on, I'm just one man. Please.
Yeah, man. If I take you out with me around the Rio, maybe around the Rio area, around the slot machines, I feel like you might take the big titty honeys from me. So I'm not sure if I want to. Yeah, I don't.
Yeah, you'll have to fight for yourself. Sometimes there are a couple others like stragglers, though. You might be able to pick up one of those.
Yeah, I get the friend of the friend of the friend, or like the backup, whatever, or stuff like that. So that'll be my. I'm gonna find a couple questions in the chat, and then we're gonna wrap things up, my friend. Get you like going on with your day out there in Vegas. What do you got planned for the night? You gonna
get down? I think I'm just supposed to see Remco and Donnie at 4, so I got about an hour to hang out before that starts. So
ask Remco about the Hollywood Girl grind. It's a new grind that Remco told me he is. I don't want to say too much about what Remco's doing with his woman life right now, even though he's getting married technically. But he brought up a new thing called the HGG, the Hollywood Girl Grind.
Oh, interesting.
And that's where you go try to meet women from Hollywood who are celebrities or actresses and stuff like that. So
wow, there you go. That's balling the shit right there.
Yeah, Remco is really about that life. And ask him about meeting women on plane, GTO. He's been coming up with a lot of strategy for meeting women on plane or meeting people on plane in general. So,
sure, nice.
You can ask him that. All right, Nathan said he asked this question like 10 times. I'll just ask the question. If you could name one person who you would back to win a bracelet this year, who would it be?
Well, I gotta pick. If there is one person that I would like somehow bless to win a World Series bracelet, it would be my friend Alex Vinovsky. He is one of the most consistent poker players at the World Series. If you go back and look at his record, he has tons of deep runs, tons of deep cashes, but no actual victories. He has final tabled the 10K pot limit hold'em. I think it's 3 times. Maybe it's only 2, and with one, you know, deep cash that wasn't actually a final table. So he's been one of my best friends for years, probably my biggest influence actually in poker as far as the actual mechanics of the game is played. You know, he plays PLO every day. He plays 4 tables of 10-20 and 5-10 PLO almost every day. So he's actually a big PLO grinder too. I know he watches your show all the time. So I would love for him to win a bracelet. He is probably one of the most underrated, under the radar, regular poker players on the circuit. So hopefully he does well. As far as first-time bracelet winners go, I don't think there'd be somebody I'd be more happy with than him.
What's his Twitter? What's his name on Twitter? I'll
A Vinovsky, A-V-E-N-O-V-S-K-I.
Cool.
Yeah, he's got like $2 million in live caches, something like that. Let's see. Yeah, last summer he had... He cashed the 10K PLO, the 5K PLO 6 max, the 3K no limit, the 10K pot limit hold'em, the 3K shootout, the 1500 6 max, and the 1500 millionaire maker. That was last year alone. And he got third in the 10K pot limit hold'em. I mean, that's a very sick summer.
That's a pretty sweet summer for sure.
Yeah, and he always puts up consistent numbers like that. He's always been a very consistent player, so hopefully he does.
I didn't give any shout outs. I usually give a lot of shout outs. Wim, what's up, Wim? Roseboom, Sarah, Nathaniel, VPIP Pro, Kevin Goldstein, Fiending, Alex P. A lot of new people in here. A lot of the Jake Carver Twitchanites have transferred over here, so we gotta give them a shout out to them.
That's great.
If it's your first time watching the podcast, you know, welcome. I do a lot of podcasts on my YouTube channel. You can go back. I have a lot of the best, debatably best players from live and online. Had Daniel on there, who's obviously a big name pro, and they're sometimes fun and in better quality apparently than what you're seeing me today. So
it's been good for the last 30 minutes, though. I think it's been better on my side at least.
Okay, good. Yeah, I don't know. I gotta get this thing fixed up here. Josh Ingedigev. I don't know how to fucking pronounce names, man. Josh Ingedelson. He's been asking a bunch of questions, so he says, "What month are you coming back, Jason? We're all sick to our stomachs waiting for you, bud. Best streamer in the business."
Wow. Well, thanks, Josh. And I think I'm going to still be streaming. Like, tomorrow I'll be streaming on, the 25K Fantasy. But I won't be back streaming regularly on PokerStars until probably August or, maybe end of July if things work out that way. But I'm not sure yet, honestly. The plans are still up in the air. I guarantee you I'll be back on by September because that's WCOOP. So I'll be back on regularly every day by September 1st. But it might be sooner. Hopefully it'll be by August. But if PokerStar says we need you in California for all of August, then I won't be back until September. So we'll see.
Well, there we go. You can follow him on Twitter at Jason Summerill if you don't already follow him. Rems, Obama, David Headland, Bruno, Chris, Marcus, all the regulars. What's up, boys? What's up, puppies? Fat Fiending says, flex your biceps. Now I'm looking a little small. I'm not going to be able to flex my biceps, guys. You all tripping right now, man. You can go. I don't flex on the camera, man. I don't do things like that.
Wow.
I'm have a fitness prep at Jason. Me and my friend have one for 3 months. Whoever can change our body aesthetically the most wins. So I'm trying to get the 6 to 8 pack in. I'm trying to get the shoulders, the chest, the biceps. Wow. So that's what we're working at here.
Grinding.
You interested in getting in the prep at too? You want to take part in that?
Dude, I would be dead fucking money. Dead fucking money, dude. I'm gonna try to go to the gym one or two times this summer. That's gonna be great. I bet you I won't get there one time. Maybe I'll get there maybe one time, dude. We'll see.
B-Had says, piss bottle GTO, Joey, don't let me down. Yeah, that's a great question, Jason. As someone who streams 7-8 hours at a time, are you one of those noobs that goes to the bathroom and pisses in the bottle? Or are you one of the guys that fucking takes the bottle out and pisses in the bottle below? What's your strategy?
I'm fucking Iron Man, dude. Me and Alex drove from Syracuse to Vegas, and I did not use the bathroom the entire drive. 28 hours, didn't use the restroom. I flew from New York to Australia, and again, did not use the restroom.
Wait, hold on. You just said you drove from New York to Australia.
Yeah, no, flew from New York to Australia, but still it was like 26 hours or something. Dude, I just have the fucking tenacity that it takes to fucking put my body into stasis.
How do you do that? What kind of sicko are you?
Dude, I'm very highly trained, a martial arts professional, dude. I can turn my body into a weapon and not have to fucking process nutrients. My body processes resources very efficiently. So I can
never had to piss? You 78 days no. You had to piss one time on the stream?
No, four. I took four breaks on over those 78 days. I took four breaks.
You went to the bathroom four times in 78 fucking days on the stream?
500 hours. I took 4 5-minute breaks. That's right, dude. I don't know what to say. Very often I would stream for 7 hours and then not go to the bathroom for another 2 hours anyway, dude. I'm just a very efficient consumer of resources, my friend.
Dear God, that might be one of the most impressive things I've ever heard in my entire life.
Yeah, I mean, that's just, I don't know, it didn't strike me as weird until I started streaming and then people started fucking calling me out on it and I was like, I don't know, I've always been that person. I never one time in my life went to the bathroom in school, never, not in public school or college or anything. No, I don't know, I just never had to, dude. I was just always been a man of discipline.
Jesus Christ, man. I mean, I have to, like, I'm think you might be a robot right now. Like, I want to make sure that you're actually, like,
it's possible. Just like it's possible, dude. Terminator on the inside. I'm going to pull my face off, and that'll be it.
What the fuck for? Fuck, I feel like I drink a lot of water, obviously, for the diet. I think it helps maximize your gains and the way you feel and stuff like that, but.
Sure. Dude, I almost take it as like, a challenge. Like, I mean, it's something, like, psychotic, almost, because I'm, like, when I watch other streamers take breaks, I'm, like, you have to take breaks? Lol. Like, Negreanu fucking took more piss breaks on stream over the course of, like, the 4 days he streamed than my entire life history. I thought that was pretty funny, but you know, he is, like, you know, 50 years old, so I understand that. But
some new people, I think they said, what about the bottle peeing thing? They probably don't know what that means. Let me explain to you what it means, guys. So sometimes when you're playing, I play a lot of 24-hour poker sessions in my life. I don't want to leave. I'm playing, I want to focus. So what you do is, instead of going to the bathroom, that's just for the noobs, you take out the bottle, typically a Gatorade bottle, something like this. Or if you want the big size, if you want to go a couple times, you get something like that. And what you do is get the bottle while you're playing. And you maximize your hourly, you maximize your overall expected value, you maximize your life EV, and you maximize your happiness EV by doing that, and also saves you time from having to get up and do something like walk into the bathroom. It's just, you just don't do things like that. So that's what
PTO, really.
I mean, really, if you're like playing, think about it, if you're these gamer guys and you're playing these games a long time, you're sitting in your beanbag chair, you don't want to go to the bathroom, just take out the fucking, I'm drinking my Gatorade, I just finished it, let me go to the bathroom. It seems so smart, I don't understand why more people don't do it. So
there you go. There you go.
I understand how to do it. All right. I think we can wrap things up, my friend. I'll let you go. Thank you for coming on, Jason. You got anything to add? You got anything you want to say? You want to ask? You want anything else?
I'll thank you for having me. And if you guys want to follow me, Twitter at Jason Somerville. My stream is runitup.tv. You can go check that out if you want over on the Twitches. I'm selling Run It Up gear, including this beautiful T-shirt. This is launching this week. You can get it at the Rio. We'll be at the 3-Bet booth the whole summer long, so you can go stop by there and check out all the Run It Up gear, the new stuff, the old stuff, the classic stuff, all going to be there. And that's about it. So thank you, my friend, for having me on. This was a lot of fun. Glad we finally made this work out.
For sure. I mean, I'm sure we'll be seeing each other out in Vegas. I'll either try to record something with you in Vegas, or you'll try to maybe record something with me. I'm sure we'll figure something out there. We'll do something in person too. That'll be fun.
For sure, dude. Absolutely. Hopefully I'll be at your final table at one of your, the 25K PLO would be ideal.
One time, maybe one time. I'm probably gonna win it. I feel like I'm going to win it.
If you're going to play, you might as well win. So that's my recommendation there.
That's true. All right, guys in the chat, thanks for tuning in. Much love. Last one. When are the V-necks hit online? When are the V-necks going official?
It should be at the end of this week. So this week should be, I think this should be the week where it'll launch. So hopefully by the end of this week, if not early next week.
All right, guys, I'm going to eat some food, and then I'll be back streaming the Scoop main events to meet him in this month. And the high, that'll be on my YouTube, too. Follow me on Twitter at JoeyingerMoine, Jason at Jason Somerville. That's it. Jason, much love, man. Much love.
Thanks, buddy. It was a lot of fun. See you soon.
I'll see you, man. Take it easy.